Divine Truth Events. These are events and presentations by Jesus and Mary. This presentation is part of the Human Soul series. The topic is Anger is Your Guide. Presented by Jesus on the 25th of April 2009 in Brisbane, Queensland, Australia. This is session one.
Today our session is going to be about anger being your guide. And already I've had the projection of some people's anger today before the group. So those of you who did that know who it was. And I'll get you back at some time. The reason why this subject is such an important subject is that a lot of people don't realise that anger is a key guide for you in your own progression towards God. And the reason why anger is such a key guide is because it's something that we all generally have a habit of falling into at some point in time, or we have a habit of suppressing at some point in time. And underneath anger is just like usually this huge iceberg of emotions. And so knowing how to work your way through anger and knowing how to feel your way through anger and then getting to the underlying emotions is very, very important. So what I'm going to, many of you will notice that I emailed, I think most of you would have received my email by now. It was done last night, so if you haven't checked your email between last night and today, the outline for this. But what I'm going to do this time is not hand you the outline until the end of the session. And that way we can interact a bit and go through the material in an interactive way, and then I'll hand you an outline as your notes that you can take home with you. Now, what I find with anger is that anger is this emotion that most of us at some point in our lives, and to be frank, most of us on a daily basis feel anger at some time. The problem is that the majority of times we don't recognise it, or we just see it as like a mild annoyance or just a little frustration or a little irritation here and there, that we have a tendency, particularly if we've been on spiritual paths, whether they be Christian or other religious basis or New Age, there is this tendency that we have to actually overlook the anger that we're actually feeling. The reason why that often happens is because we're so ingrained in this idea that anger means you're not spiritual, or anger means that you're not connected with God, or anger is wrong. Now, while it is true that anger is a very damaging emotion, and can be a very damaging emotion, particularly if it's held on to, the expression of anger is something that's a natural thing based on the deeper things that we choose to suppress. So for that reason, anger is a really good guide into your deeper emotions. Every single time you feel angry, frustrated, annoyed, or any of these even slight annoyance, or slight irritation even, there is usually a huge emotion under it that you're avoiding, and you're choosing to avoid it. And what I'd like to do today is illustrate how to actually dig underneath that, start allowing your anger to surface, and then start allowing what's underneath the surface. Because in a lot of ways, your anger is also almost the gateway into these other emotions. And that's particularly the case if you had suppressed your anger when you were a child. Now, most of us have heavy suppressed anger from childhood. The reason why is that most of us, when we expressed our anger when we were children, what normally happened to us? You usually got a cloud over the ear, didn't you? Or you got something happened to you that was very painful. You might have got sent to your room. You might have got ostracized, punished. And there's lots of things that happen to little children in order to shut down their anger. Often we get ignored, like when we're angry. So I'm being angry as a child and then I'm getting ignored. What's that teaching me? I'm not going to get loved while I'm angry. I've got to stop being angry if I'm going to be loved. So there's a lot of hidden messages that come to a little child right from the time they're very, very young, that causes them to suppress their anger and their rage. And unfortunately, there's usually a layer placed on top of their anger and rage. So for a child, for example, let's say we're a child, say a 3 or 4 year old child. At 3 or 4 years of age, we are almost the perfect reflection of what our parents are denying. So if our parents are having an emotion, let's say the parents have an emotion where they feel unloved. As a child, if I'm 3 or 4 years of age, I'll be perfectly reflecting that emotion. In other words, the child will be feeling unloved. And then what the child does is reflects that emotion through the law of attraction back to the parent. So when the parent denies an emotion, the child acts out the emotion. And then what does the parent generally do? Punish the child for acting out the parent's own emotion. Now, how frustrating is that? If you got punished every single time, and this is what happened during your childhood, you got punished probably every single time you acted out one of your parents' emotions that they were trying to deny. And most of us grew up in this kind of environment. So here we are, trying to connect. We're just the perfect little reflectors. We can't even help ourselves being a perfect reflector when we're so young like that. And instead of being allowed even to reflect the emotion back at our parent, the reflection is actually suppressed through punishment or through the parent's anger or through the parent's rejection or through... And that just bottles up huge amounts of emotions in us. And the only way to access those underlying emotions is going to be to go through the bottled up anger that's there as a child and into those other bottled up emotions that were before the anger even arose. So can you see that knowing how to and dealing with anger is going to be a very essential part of your own progression? The other issue that we face is often as an adult, because of these childhood emotions, we start creating a lot of things about ourselves that are not true. We create these fictitious viewpoints of ourselves that we then want to maintain as an adult. And we'll do almost anything to defend the castle. And rage or anger is a major way of defending the castle. Like, how do you find dealing with someone who's angry with you? Don't you find that it's really difficult? Like, isn't it difficult because what are they doing? They're trying to control you or manipulate you generally, or they want something from you that you're not giving them. And so it's a major way that we can use to actually explore having others do what we want. And so anger becomes a way in which we can control others. Like, you go to a supermarket, who's the one who gets the free product? Like, that they got, you know, they got a bad product, let's say, and they get the free product as well as the original product, the good one, in return. Who's the one? Usually it's the one who goes up there and who's the irate customer, isn't it? You notice that, how that happens a lot? The irate customer gets served, and the person who's nice and calm and collected and waiting to be served, they get forgotten. But why is that? Because anger is what we're so used to responding to. We're so used to responding to anger rather than actually love. And that's why these things happen in our daily life. So it's really, really important to look at this issue of anger. But before we start, what I would like to do, and to just connect you to emotionally to the subject, is play some mediumship that I did around, it would have been a year or so ago, a year and a half ago now, when I was in Barbados with a lady called Natalie, who was a medium. And we actually finished up speaking to a group of slaves who had been in the spirit world for quite a lot of years, in the hills of the spirit world, for quite a number of years, and who had quite a lot of anger within them. And what I would like to do is play this recording for you. It takes some time. It's about, I think, a 45-minute recording altogether, explaining where I go through a heap of things, explaining to these spirits the condition they're in, why they're in this condition, and so forth. And that'll just help you connect to how anger can lock you up and prevent you from actually progressing on your spirit, on your journey. You see, while I've said that anger is your guide, suppressed anger or unexperienced anger will be devastating to you. It will wreck your body and wreck your life and in the spirit world do the same thing unless you decide to experience it. And that's why it's so important to begin to look at this issue of anger. Now, I've had many discussions with anger over the years about the subject of anger to groups of people. So what I've tried to do in the outline that you will have got by now, or that you'll get after the session, is outline most of the reasons why we get angry, and outline most of the reasons of or what we do to suppress our anger. So to be frank with you, many of you in the audience feel that you're not a very angry person, and yet a lot of the times I can feel extreme rage coming from you. And so that means that you've become so used to suppressing your anger that now you don't even know that you're angry. Does that make sense? And there's a lot of reasons why you do that. And what we want to do is start exposing those reasons. Then later in the session, what we want to do is start talking about some practical ways in which we can actually connect to our anger and start actually connecting even to what's underneath the anger. Because there's some really practical things you can do. And I'll be inviting somebody up. Ian will come up with his anger kit, and he'll show you some of the things that he does with his anger. And you'll see that you all have the choice to actually go into these emotions or avoid them. Now, if you choose to avoid them, you're going to have a pseudo covering of spirituality that has no substance. It's when you connect to them and experience them and release them that you'll have true spiritual connection with God. So that's why it's such an important subject. So what I'll do first is just play this recording. I'm sorry if it's not that clear, but hopefully you'll be able to hear it with the way I've got it set up. We'll just see how we go.
I'm feeling to be asked to speak, to come forward. I have been asked to speak on behalf of.
Can everyone hear that?
There are a lot of us here. One person must speak, so I have agreed. I'm not sure how to explain. I've been encouraged to say how I'm feeling to explain my situation, because things are the same for many of us here. I am being asked to talk about myself. If there is an understanding that everyone who is around me is feeling the same way, but I have been asked to just speak for myself. But I know there are numbers of you there, and understand that there are several hundred of us here. I am in a very dark place. I do not like it here. I have never liked it here. In fact, I hate it here. I really hate it here, and I hate everybody around me, and I hate you, and I hate me. And I have felt like this for a long time. I do not really understand why I am here, and why things are not the way I expected them to be. I know I passed into the spirit world, which is not nice, which is disgusting, quite some time ago. I am not sure how long ago. I am being told that I cannot tell you how long I was here, because it is too long. I do not wish to say out loud exactly how long I have been here, because it is too long. I lived on the island of Barbados, where you are, and I was treated so very badly by the plantation owner. there were men, white men, who beat me most days, and they beat me because I was not working hard enough, and they beat me when I was not capable of doing any more. I was treated like a dog, and when I longed to die. We all longed to die. And when I died, things were no better. I moved from one hell into the next hell. And I did believe that there was a God. I did believe that I would be saved, that there would be salvation for us once we died. And there is nothing. There is nothing here, and none of us can understand why there is that nothing, why we are still in such miserable conditions, why we still feel like those downtrodden slaves, why we still feel that those people who treated us so badly are somehow still with us, are somehow still affecting how we are feeling. And why was there not some justice? Why do we still feel so bad? Why must we continue to be punished? And why must I carry on like this all the time without ending? Why?
Well, I can certainly understand your confusion at the moment, but perhaps if I could just make a few suggestions that where we can try and investigate a few of the things that you've said to see whether they are true. Not the things that you've said in terms of your life, but rather the things you've said about whether what's happening is just and why are you in the current location and all of those kinds of things. Investigate some of those things. And have you ever seen any brighter spirits come to you to try to talk to you?
Just now. I am being corrected. I have not seen much. I have been so angry and miserable and not wanting to see anything worse than I am already experiencing. I do not wish to see anything more than I am seeing. However, I would say that for me to be speaking to you now, there has been a very kind spirit has come and suggested that I have nothing to lose, that I must try this experiment and see what happens, that it is an opportunity that would be worth taking. So here I am. But as I am talking to you, I am getting quite nervous, and I am anxious. I have a concern that somehow this is a trick, although I can feel that you are good people.
Well, perhaps I can firstly explain the reason why you are in the current location you are in the spirit world. But firstly, I would like to firstly suggest that to you that there are in fact many thousands of locations in the spirit world where you could be. But where you currently are depends upon the feelings that you're feeling inside of yourself. And one of the
feelings that's most dominant in you at the moment, as you mentioned, is the rage that you feel inside of yourself, the deep anger and hatred you feel for people generally, and also for yourself. Right? And that anger is actually suppressing some deeper emotions within you that you're afraid to feel within yourself. And it's that that's actually creating your current location and it's keeping you in the current location. You're in the spirit world. The reason why it's keeping you there is because if you were in a nice, happy place, you would still have this anger inside of yourself. And so you would then be projecting this anger at everyone around you. So one of the things that is going to need to happen is for you to connect to why you're so angry and start feeling all of the emotions underneath the anger, which include the sadness and the terrible despair and emptiness that you felt when you're on Earth, and the huge injustices that were done to you while you're on Earth.
I expected justice to be done when I passed. I was expecting that somehow things would be put right.
Yeah.
That it was one thing to be treated so badly by men of another skin colour when I was alive. It is another thing to still feel like this now. Where is the justice? Why did things not change?
Well, what if I prove to you firstly that there is some justice in what's happening at the moment, just by being able to show you the location in the spirit world of where the people are who harmed you? Would you? The problem with doing this with you is that you may be tempted to actually visit them and torment them in your current.
I'm confused now because I'm being told not to trust you.
And who's telling you that?
Someone has come to the side and said, do not trust, do not trust.
And what?
This is a trick, this is not real, this is...
And who is the person who's come and told you that? Do you mind telling me who that is?
I do not know who they are, babe. I don't think I know. Who are you? They are someone from close by. That's all I know.
Why are they unwilling to give you specific information?
I do not know. They are just saying, do not trust, do not trust.
Why are they not wanting to trust?
They say it's a trick. They say we should just stay where we are, that we can do no better.
Why do they want you to stay where you are? Do you want to stay where you are?
No, I do not want to stay where I am.
So it would seem to me like they're just trying to repress you and keep you in the same place. Isn't that exactly what the slave owners did on Earth?
I understand what you're saying, but this is strong. There are more now. There are more around us. They are all saying the same thing. They are saying it to me, and they are saying it to the others all around me.
But you don't need to listen to them. You see, what the problem is that...
It is hard to not listen to them. They are here, and they are in our ears.
Well, we can prevent them if you want. Do you want to stop them from doing this?
What do I do? I
don't need to do anything. We can just ask some of our spirit friends to ask them.
How do I know we can trust you? How do I know I can trust you? Why would they have come and said this if there was not some truth?
Well, that they want you to stay where you currently are. I, as you know from reading me, I want you to be able to be in a happier place. So, myself and they...
They are saying you're lying. They are saying you're lying. They are saying do not trust. Stay where you are. Things will get worse. Why would this be happening?
Things won't get worse, and I can prove that to you. To prove that to you, we've got to remain talking. So it's up to you. I can prove these things to you that I'm saying. It's just a matter of you keep an open mind or not.
I will try.
Okay. Do you want people in your ear telling you not to?
No, I do not.
Okay, well, let's ask some higher spirits who are brighter and more loving to ask those spirits to move on. We can talk to them later if they want to.
They are moving back.
Okay. All right. Well, let's first There's some bright spirits around you who haven't shown themselves to you. But what I would like to do is just for a moment that they show themselves to you so that you can see there's quite a number of bright spirits around you as a group. And these spirits are quite happy spirits, aren't they? They look happy. And they look content. You see that?
This is how I thought I would think.
Yes. So what we want to do is first show you what's going on really, because at the moment there's a lot of things going on around you that you're not really aware of, and what I would like to do is just help you become more aware of something.
Well, it is difficult. There are arguments, there is shouting, no, don't do that.
Why is that? Why don't they want to do this?
There is fighting. There is arguing. There is...
Well, the question I have for all of you is this. Do you want to stay where you are?
No.
Would you rather be in a better place?
Yes.
Well, the only way to get in a better place is to investigate what I'm saying. You can always go back to where you are, if that's what you want. So if after checking out these different things that I suggest to you, you want to go back to where you currently are, that's okay, that's your choice. You're allowed to do that. But you'll find that you won't want to after I've shown you some of the things that I want to show you. You understand?
I do.
And all of those ones who are arguing, fighting, if you just stop arguing and fighting for a while, you know, haven't you had enough arguments and fights with people who have oppressed you? Why do you want to still be oppressed? Why do you want to oppress each other? Do you follow me?
I understand. I am not one of those fighters.
Okay. But all those ones who are fighting, if they can just bear that in mind that, you know, all you're doing is harming yourself when you do this. If we can just investigate these things that we can look at, and then you'll be able to see whether you can trust me or not trust me, that's up to you after we've investigated these things. Does that sound alright?
Yes.
Okay. Well, the first thing I'd like to show you is the condition in which the people who harmed you, where they are. Generally, the people that harmed you, where they actually live in the spirit world now. Now, to do that, these bright spirits who are around you will actually help you go to those locations. They'll stay with you the entire time, and then they will bring you back to your current location. Are you okay with that? Can you trust them enough to do that?
Yes, I am curious. I am interested in this.
Okay. Well, let's firstly do that then. So we'll just spend a little bit of time waiting to go off and have a look at the condition in which these people who harmed you are currently.
In particular, the condition of your soul is one where you are very, very angry.
and not...
Why is he not in a fiery hell?
Because there is no fiery hell.
He should be in a fiery hell, and all other men like him.
And why do you feel that way? And this is one part of the reason why you are where you are. Do you understand what I just said?
No.
You see, you're so angry with what he did to you, right? But now you hate everything around you, don't you?
Yeah.
And that's the reason why you are where you are, because of the hatred that you're keeping within you, that you're not releasing, that you're not allowing yourself to get let out of you. And the reason why you're holding on to hatred is because you do not want to cry. You do not want to feel sad. You don't want to feel despair about the things that happened to you.
I want all those masters to burn in hell forever.
And that's the reason why you are where you are.
I want every man who treated us and all other men like us to suffer.
That's the reason why you are where you are.
Forever.
And that's the reason why you are where you are.
Where is the justice?
Well, there's complete justice. Because if you were in a more loving place, where you could actually go through the process of letting go of these feelings of hatred and anger inside of yourself, and connecting with the sadness inside of yourself, you would find that you would be able to very rapidly get into a beautiful place. And the only thing that's keeping you where you are is this anger and resentment that you feel about what happened when you're on Earth. That's the only thing that's keeping you here where you are. There's nothing else keeping you there.
So, what do I do?
Well, instead of feeling anger and resentment, well, all that is doing is covering over how you really feel inside. And how you really feel inside is a feeling of sadness about life. You feel all of that injustices and everything, but you're not allowing yourself to connect to how much sadness you actually feel in your heart about your life. And if you would choose to allow to feel these emotions, these sad emotions that you actually have, you could be taken right now to a new location that would be much more beautiful. But while you choose to stay in this place of anger, rather than choosing to connect to the sadness, you are going to remain in your current state and in your current location.
I cannot feel sadness. I can feel anger. I can feel frustration. I can feel that I want revenge. I can feel that it isn't fair. I can feel... I don't know. I cannot feel sadness. It is not there.
No, it is there. All of these emotions that you've just listed are all covering over the sadness. They are emotions that you use to try and feel powerful when inside of yourself you actually feel very weak and vulnerable.
I do not ever want to feel that way again. That is how I felt when I was being treated so badly.
I know. And that is why you were staying where you are. Because once you choose to be weak and vulnerable and let yourself feel those underlying emotions, you will get out of this location and be in a new location that is more happy. The instant you do this, you will be able to move.
Why must I feel like that again?
Because in the end, the way you will feel if you want to progress towards God, and there is a God, and if you want to progress towards God, you will become like a child. And a child is vulnerable with their emotions. They let themselves feel all of their emotions. And the only way for you to progress towards God is to allow yourself to feel all of your emotions. So the reason why you're being kept in your current condition by yourself is your choosing that's keeping you here, by the way, is because you are choosing to not be vulnerable because of all of that hurt that you have that happened to you on Earth. You have been so hurt that you now don't want to feel vulnerable ever again. And the problem is, if you would like to progress, you will need to become softer, more vulnerable, more loving, more considerate, more open, less hateful. All of those things are needed for you to progress, to be in a better location. And to do that, you're going to have to let yourself cry about all of these things that happened to you. Now, if you choose to let yourself cry about all these things, our spirit friends will be able to take you to a new location. But if you choose to hold on to your anger and hold on to your resentment and justify it by these things that have happened in the past, then you will remain in your current location. Now, just to prove to you that there is a new location that you can go to, what I'm going to do is get the spirit friends that are with you, the ones who are brighter, to actually show you a picture of where they live. Right? So for a moment, if they can show you a picture of where they live.
Feeling that you need to feel.
Can and we get them to show you some of the sadness that they haven't connected. Are you willing to do that?
Yeah.
And what about the one who's with you now? If he shows you some of the sadness that you haven't connected.
Oh. That's quite mine. I can see that. That's me.
Yeah.
That's how I was.
Yeah.
That's how I am.
Yeah.
I see that.
Yeah. And can he tell you how, what happened when he let himself feel that sadness?
There was more beauty. There was a better place. That slowly got better and better. And now he is happy.
And is he on the divine path or is he on the natural path?
I do not know.
You can ask.
I could be happy. Have I ever been happy?
Not really, no.
So how can I be happy if I have never been happy?
Well, you will see that it's possible. If you let yourself.
But I have not got that. That is not my luck to. How can that? I know. I cannot be happy because I have never been happy. And this place,
what about,
when I died, it's not how I thought it would be.
But what about the spirit who's with you? Can he show you that he wasn't happy either, was he?
No.
And he had a terrible life on earth too, didn't he?
He had very similar treatment to me. I was locked in a shed for much of my adult life and just allowed out to work. I felt that God was punishing me for being alive, that I was bad, that black people were somehow bad, and that this is why we were being treated in this way.
No, God actually loves you. What is your name? Can you tell me your name?
My friends call me Joe.
Well, Joe, God actually loves you very much. And God just wants to help you get through this anger and connect with all the sadness so that you can be closer to Him. But it's been the anger that's been holding you away from God. Into a point where you're willing to feel your own vulnerability, where you're willing to feel your own sadness.
the beatings and everything that I went through.
Not so much the pain of the beatings, because you've already felt that. It's more the emotional pain that you felt at the time that you didn't allow yourself to experience. The sadness that you felt at the time. The terrible despair that you felt, that you just wanted to get away from. You need to allow yourself to feel that. That's what you were using your anger to get away from.
That is hard.
It is hard. But you have lots and lots of hope. If you're...
And this, if I do this, I can go there?
Yes. If you do this, you'll
probably... What else is there? Are there things that we will like there?
Well, about 4 months ago, or maybe a bit longer now, we talked to a group of slaves who were in your current position, who were slaves on Earth, in Barbados, I think, too. So, can we perhaps ask those group of slaves to come now? They're all there now.
Oh, these were slaves?
Yeah, just 4 months ago on Earth.
You were slaves? You do not look like I look.
So how do they look to you now?
They look so different. They look happy.
Yeah.
They look good.
Yeah.
We don't look like that.
No.
They look good. I like that. What else would be there?
Would I even like to show you a picture of where they live now?
That is different. Why is it different?
Than the first pictures?
Yeah.
How different are they?
It is better. They seem to be somewhere better.
Well, the reason why is that they chose to follow this path called the Divine Path, which is the path of connecting to God. Does that make sense? They chose to follow this path of actually connecting to God and longing for God's love to enter them as they've been progressing. And that causes them to progress very much more quickly. So they can get into happier places even than the first group of spirits who came to show you can get. Does that make sense?
I can go there too.
You can go there too. And in fact,
I can choose.
You can go there. You can choose, yeah. You can choose between one or the other. And also, you can go there as fast as what those groups of spirits went there. I think it was only 3 or 4 months ago on Earth time that we spoke to them. So it wasn't that long ago that we spoke to them, and now they're in those new locations.
So what do I do?
Well, what you do is you need to listen to those ones who have done this progression before you. And they will tell you exactly what you need to do, and you need to trust them. But it's going to involve you feeling your emotions, not just feeling angry. Every time you feel angry, you are stopping your progression. You understand that?
So, I had times when I cried, when I was locked in that shed. I have to do that.
Let yourself feel those emotions, yes. If you let yourself feel those emotions, then...
I do not understand how that will take me there to that beautiful place.
Well, what happens is when you feel an emotion, the emotion leaves you. It physically leaves you and it leaves your soul. You are actually made up of a soul that you can't see. That is your emotions and your feelings and your passions and your desires. And when those emotions that are negative or sad leave you, you can actually then travel to a happier place. But if the emotions that are sad stay in you, then you are going to only be able to stay in the place where you currently are. That's the way the universe works. There are many other secrets about the universe that these spirits would like to tell you. So it's just a matter of trusting some of these first things and just seeing whether what they're saying to you works. In other words, experiment with them. They have been slaves just like you, right? And they are now free men, aren't they? And they feel love now, don't they?
Yes.
Can you feel some of the love they have for you?
Yes.
So they feel love now. They don't feel hatred now. So somehow they got from the condition you were in where you're feeling angry and hatred or whatever, sad and in despair, to this new location. Somehow they got there. Does that make sense? And they got there very quickly. So if you listen to how they did that, you will obviously be able to also progress to that same location.
I would like that.
It's just a matter of trusting.
I'm going to take a chance. I took a chance talking in this way.
Yep.
I'm going to take another chance.
It'll be good. I was thinking, after, if the group, how are the group of the spirits feeling with you? Are they all willing to, some of them willing to take a chance too?
Yep, the two will take a chance with me.
Well, what I've recommended, all of you that are willing to take a chance and work through some of these emotions, when you've done that and you go to these new locations, to come back and tell the others that what I'm saying is actually true. About, you know, come back and talk about your experience.
We can do that. We can come back.
We'll be able to come back.
We will see.
Okay.
We are not sure if we would ever, if we can go back, if we can go to those different places. Why would I want to come back here?
Just
I don't want to. Well, they should come now. They should come with us now. We don't want to come back. We leave. We're not coming back.
Well, you may feel differently in time.
I don't think so. I don't want to come back. If I can get out of here, I am never, ever coming back. I don't know. Maybe.
Just have a think about
that. So there are quite a few of us now. We're ready.
All right. Now, if you can go in with your spirit friends and have a chat with them now about what you need to do, okay? They will talk to you about experiencing your emotions of sadness and how to connect with those emotions. Let yourself follow what they're saying. Because they've already done what you were about to do, so they know how to do this. So let yourself trust it and connect with what they're saying to you.
How long will it take before there are changes?
Well, it depends on how much you let yourself think, feel your emotion. That's the first thing. And the second thing is it depends upon whether you also connect to God or not. So if you choose to not connect to God, it'll be a lot slower. If you choose to connect to God, it'll be a lot faster. So it just depends on what choices you make at this point as to how fast it will be.
I feel bad about connecting to God.
Because you sort of feel some anger there too, right? Like God has punished you in the past. But that's not true, actually. The only reason why you are where you are right now is because you chose to hold on to this anger. There's been some people who have passed who have experienced exactly what you have experienced, but they let go of all their anger and they cried about it and they've progressed right into other places that are much more happy. But because of the choice you made...
Could God's not connect to me?
Could
not. That would be easier. Why can't God connect to me?
God can only connect to you if you allow yourself to feel all of your emotions. And the problem that you've had is that you've been turning off all of your emotions. You haven't been wanting to feel all of your emotions. You've been wanting to blame others for all of the emotions that are within you. Right? And it's fine. A lot of the people did create these emotions in you. But unless you're willing to experience your own emotions, you will not be able to experience God's emotions. Does that make sense? How can God's emotions flow through you when you don't let your emotions flow through you?
This is a lot. This is a lot to deal with.
Well, these spirits who have done it before you can help you in every process. So
this is changing everything.
That's right. to take, you want to change everything, but you don't want to be where you are. Why be with where you are one more second when you don't need to be?
I will give it a try.
Now, the spirits who were being held back, who were telling you not to give it a try, right? What we'll do is perhaps we'll talk with them after you leave as to why they feel so afraid for you giving these things a try.
They're still here.
So what if you go up with those spirits now who are ready to help you, Janet, and the group of spirits with you, they can all go up together and you can all give these things a try and let yourself feel your emotions. You need to bear in mind that you're going to feel really sad, right? You're going to need to release some of this sadness. But if you also need to bear in mind that if you involve God, that God's love will start entering in you and you will feel that and things will change very rapidly for you if you let yourself do that.
I want to go to a nicer place.
Yeah. Yeah. So let yourself do that and you try those experiments and perhaps we can talk to these spirits that were feeling afraid about you trying these things.
Good. We're ready to go.
It's been nice to meet you, Joe.
It's been nice to meet you. It's been quite a new feeling and experience. I'm glad I took a chance.
So am I.
And if what you say is true, I am looking forward to is this a life? I don't know anything. Is this a life I'm living?
Still the same life, yeah.
A new life. Yeah. Then a new life. I'm looking forward to. Three others want me to say thank you.
Peter.
The ones that came around and were trying to stop them,
yep.
Had they come from a lower location?
Yes.
Motivated by
hatred.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I finished up speaking to the ones afterwards, the ones in a lower location, and within 2 days, almost every single person who was with me on that trip hated me. Within 2 days.
In this physical realm.
As a result of those spirits.
Yeah. As a result of those spirits now influencing the people that were on Earth who were in anger, and these ones connected to them, and within 2 days, the majority of the people I travelled with were in a rage with me.
What did they say was the reason for the rage?
Because they couldn't trust me anymore. Exactly the words that the spirit spoke is exactly the words that they told me.
How long ago was this?
This was about just over a year ago, 12, 14 months ago. Yeah. In that one afternoon session, three of the women that I was travelling with, since then they've never spoken to me. From that one afternoon session of those spirits, the ones who were trying to influence the slave spirits, and they finished up influencing quite a number of our group. So this is last night we had a mediumship session. It just shows you some of the things that can happen in the mediumship session if you choose to deny your own emotion. Yes, some people did work through their emotions. So Angela, where are you, Angela? You want to come up for a second? Oh, no, do I have to? Testing. Come on, Ange. Hold the mic. Up close like that. Ange was there with me. She was actually she was in Barbados at the time this happened. Ange is not, this is impromptu by the way, so Ange doesn't know this was going to happen. So Ange was one of those persons who was quite angry at this session that we had that afternoon. And They were quite, the whole discussion, in fact, that I had besides the discussion with the spirits was a discussion about anger. And the reason why I had a discussion about anger is because Ange and another one of my sisters were quite angry. And so that triggered off the discussion. Now, Angela has since worked through a lot of that anger that she was feeling. And so Angela has spoken to me the entire time since, actually. And whereas quite a number of the others who were there now don't speak to me at all. Could you describe what you felt when those other spirits came to talk?
The ones at the end.
The ones at the end.
Oh, they were awful. They were sinister. They were. It was just eerie and quite awful.
Yeah.
They were in a really, really bad condition. Worse than me.
I could notice
that.
Yeah. And what were they trying to do to those slave spirits?
Well, they were just trying to cause any damage that they could, trying to stop them. And, yeah, they were just horrible. I mean, not the sort of people you want to meet in a dark alley.
Yeah.
Sort of
thing. So evil. Evil.
Yeah, evil.
People.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. And, sorry?
No.
I'll try to go a bit higher.
I think she just needs to hold on closer.
Just need to hold a bit closer. That's right. I'd like you to chew on it.
Okay.
That's it. Now, do you remember what happened a few days later when we went from Barbados to Miami?
Yes.
And what were the people who were upset with me saying?
Yeah, exactly. I came down for breakfast one morning and, can I mention names or not? Two of the women.
Yeah, just...
Two of the women that were travelling with us, I sort of didn't know what was going on, but I came down and they were sitting in the foyer and the two of them were just having a discussion about that we can't trust AJ anymore. And AJ had done nothing different at all. The only thing different was that we picked up these spirits. And the lady who was saying that she felt, well, both of them were quite mediumistic. I was lucky I wasn't. so they were going through a lot of stuff of mistrusting and actually feeling as though they wanted to actually stop the trip and go home. It was that bad for them.
Yeah. So that was just from the influence of these spirits. So what emotions must be in the person's being influenced then? Mm-hmm. You see how it all works? There's this law of attraction happening. Now, in the case of Angela, Angela wanted to deal with the emotion of anger that she felt. So what did you do after that? Like the anger of emotion of anger that you felt, that we discussed that afternoon?
Well, I started crying actually when Joe was talking about never wanting to be vulnerable again and never wanting to be hurt again, because I'd realised that my anger was triggered by a man who was triggered into exactly that feeling. I didn't want to be vulnerable around a man who was a big man too, and he wasn't actually projecting anger at me, but he wasn't actually having an argument with me. He was having an argument with his wife when it happened. And I was actually living there with him for 2 weeks and I felt really uncomfortable. And I didn't want to feel vulnerable, so I just got angry.
Yeah.
And I wasn't abusing him angry, I was just angry in him and projecting that at him. So AJ was addressing that and I was like, no, I don't think I'm angry. I think you're wrong.
Yeah.
But when the slave started saying about how he was treated on Earth and that he'd never been happy and all of the emotions, and I connected with them again now. I just felt, okay, I get that now, that's why I'm here. So I actually started to be vulnerable. Felt like I realised that I didn't want to be vulnerable, that's why I got angry. And immediately after, or during the session, I went into the toilet and had a big bawl.
Yeah. So instantly you chose to actually feel the underlying emotion,
yeah,
rather than the anger itself.
Yeah.
Although for 2 weeks, almost you've been feeling the anger.
Yeah.
So can you see the relationship between anger and what's underneath the anger? Mm-hmm. And you see that in that example with those spirits. So you travelled a bit further along with me to England as well, and you've felt the deterioration of the relationship with the other ladies in the group.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a huge difference, wasn't there, between the choice to deal with the emotion,
yeah,
and what the avoidance of the emotion.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And what were your feelings about my treatment of those people?
That was quite loving. It was quite loving, and you were treating them just the same as everyone else.
And did I
treated them any worse?
Did I treat them the same as what I was treating before that.
Oh, yeah. So nothing had changed. Nothing had changed. You hadn't changed it at all. All we did was that she did that channeling, and then from then on, things started to get bad. And that's the thing, like,
and
you,
ironically,
you never changed.
And ironically, even now, these people are using exactly the same words that those spirits were using about me. So can you see how easy it is just to be influenced if you hold on to an emotion? Just how easy it is to be influenced down a certain road. If you choose, like Angela chose to deal with the emotion, there's hardly any influence then that it can affect you with going down that road. So it's still an emotion you're working through, isn't it? This emotion of anger.
Every day.
Yeah. And you're getting to the now the bottom of these emotions. So, yeah. So now Angela's been working with that probably since then, about 14 months or so. Isn't it? It's probably been. It was about March or something, wasn't it then? So now it's about 13 or 14 months, and Angela's now really sinking into the bottom of what is the cause of her wanting to get into anger and starting to feel those emotions. So can you describe it? Like, it's a lot of grief that you've had to work your way through, wasn't it?
Yeah, a lot of grief, feeling like I wanted to die. That a lot of what Joe was saying, that my life had never been happy. How would I ever know happiness?
Despair,
really.
Yeah. Okay.
And I would have thought, I would have said, 2 years ago, I would have said I was quite happy.
Exactly. And did you feel very angry 2 years ago?
I knew I was angry. There was a film I watched years ago. I think it was Terms of Endearment or something with Shirley MacLaine.
Yep.
And she said, I think it was that movie anyway, and she said she cracked off with this kid for being on a lawn or something, and someone said something about her being angry, and she said, yeah, well, I've been just angry for 20-something years. And that line in that movie, I went, oh, I relate to that. So I knew I was angry, but not...
But not that it sort of mattered to
No, it was just like that state that you said before. It was like mild irritation constantly. Gary will tell you.
Okay, well, thank you, Ange, for sharing that with us. So, what have you learned from all of that? Don't suppress your emotions. Particularly, do you want to actually, we need to, yes, come on. We need to do this because a lot of these CDs are not getting the audience's comments and we need to start getting them. So please, pretty please, come on. If you would have known, you never asked this, would you? What was your name?
Lisa.
So what was your question, Lisa? You only have to be up here for the question.
Yeah, okay. I just thought that the spirit started switching into anger at that moment when they lost trust.
Yeah.
So what's that thing when you lose trust? What's going on there? Like, are you confused or are you in fear?
Yes.
I don't understand trust.
No worries, I'll explain. Good question. The reason why we get into anger when we lose trust is because we're actually covering over a deep fear of the emotion of confusion. What we need to do instead is just allow ourselves to sink into that emotion of confusion and feel it, to feel confused, and to feel the lack of trust that we have, and to actually voice it and express it. You'll notice all the way through the discussion I had with those spirits that I was always encouraging them to voice their true emotions. And after a while, they got so used to it right from the beginning that they were now expressing their true emotions. Like, he said he hated me. And I could feel when he said that, his hatred towards me, this spirit, this slave spirit. He hated me because I was white. He hated me because I was in Barbados, in a nice apartment, talking to him when he was in a terrible place. There was lots and lots of reasons why he hated me in that particular moment. And it just encouraged him to express his emotion. When we start getting into emotions of confusion, usually there's a lot of fear associated with them, and we don't want to feel those emotions. And so as soon as we suppress any emotion, and confusion is an emotion, just like all these other emotions, and as soon as we suppress any emotion, that's when you'll be tempted to get into anger instead. That's when you'll be tempted again to push things away from you. So allow yourself to get into every emotion. Now, obviously, that takes a fair bit of courage. I'll just turn that down a bit.
That takes a fair bit of courage. Courage that many of us feel we don't have. But courage is another emotion, and it's one that God can give you. So pray to God for courage to deal with your emotions. That's a major thing that we can always do. You see, if you choose to not feel an emotion, you will get angry. Now, how you deal with that anger may be many variety of ways. Like, there's been so many examples I could bring up, but you know, there's a way of like going into calmness, you know, the Zen Buddhist type style of dealing with the anger. You know, meditate, breathe, get yourself out of the anger. You can do that, but you'll need to do that every day for the rest of your life. And when you pass into the spirit world, you still won't have forgotten your anger. The anger will still be inside of you. And you'll still need to actually connect to it at some point to release it. Remember that every time an emotion passes through you, it's released. Every time you store an emotion, the moment you store the emotion, now it's not released and it defines you then. So the key is to let every emotion pass through you. No worries. Questions will be up here. I'm sorry about that, but it's just so that we can get to the questions. Bit high for you. I like doing that. You can't go up.
This is something that's gone on. This is something that's gone on for over 20 years. Even before I was married, we were driving in the car.
You need to stop now. Mm. You need to ask the question. Because I know. You don't need to tell me the story.
Okay.
I know the story. You just need to ask the question.
Why do I create so much pain in my body when I'm in such a state of confusion? It was like last night going home in the car, there was so much anger and rage come up because I got lost.
Yep.
And put me in the car, even with a map, even with a GPS,
yep.
It still took me an hour to get home when it could have taken 15 minutes.
Yes.
So then this morning my friend, on the computer, I'd done a printout. So I had a printout, I had a GPS, and I had my Revidex. Still took me a fucking hour.
Okay, so lots of anger.
And, yeah, and I did some screaming.
Yeah.
So what it does to my stomach, it just creates so much pain.
Turmoil inside of you. So the question is, why do I get into so much pain when I get into this angry state?
Yes.
I'll answer that. You can say. Okay. And you'll be finding over the coming months, I'll be getting very specific with stories. Okay. We have a desire to tell stories because we have a desire to get away from the emotion generally. And we'll talk about that maybe in another session. This is what's happening when we get into pain. So, here's our pain. The pain, in this case I'm talking about physical pain. So pain that's inside of your body. Underneath the pain is the desire to deny an emotion. Every single time you exercise your desire to deny an emotional experience, you will experience a physical pain. Every single time. Now, why is it then when I'm in anger that I'm feeling more pain? It's because when I'm in anger, I'm in the desire to deny an underlying emotion. Does that make sense? And that's what is creating the pain. So yes, when you experience your anger, you will have some very strong physical pain symptoms in your body. Because that is the result of
denying the underlying emotion. So what is the underlying emotion? Well, firstly, the desire to deny an emotion comes from a fear about the emotion. In other words, I will only not feel an emotion, or choose to not feel emotion, because I'm afraid of what might happen if I feel that emotion. Okay? So, what might happen to me if I do feel my anger? What do I feel might happen? Well, if I was a child feeling anger, what normally occurred? Punishment. So most of us have that emotion in us. Or if we weren't punished physically with a slap or, you know, some kind of physical pain, what other types of punishment did we receive if we felt anger? Being ignored. Rejected. Emotional rejection. Right? So if I'm getting into anger and then denying my anger, I'm afraid of those things occurring. So I need to deal with that fear. They're the blockages that are there. Underneath the fear will generally be some more causal or base emotions. Now, I'll write them as causal emotions, but usually what happens is there is a layer of emotions that get down to the causal emotion. So there'll be pain is the result of my desire to suppress an emotion. I only ever desire to suppress an emotion because I'm afraid of it, right? And if I'm afraid of it, then I need to allow myself to experience why I'm afraid of it. And usually that will also be a childhood experience of some kind. And I call that dealing with your blocks. Right? You will not be able to access your causal emotion until you deal with your blocks. And to be frank, anger is one of those blocks. So every time you get into an angry state, you are in a blocked state. Now, I'm not saying don't experience your anger. I'm saying don't stay in your anger. I don't mean get out of it by actually tuning out of it. I mean get out of your anger by fully experiencing your anger and then realizing that it's a choice that you're making to get away from an underlying emotion. Make the choice to get into that emotion now, rather than keeping on choosing to get away from it. So if you choose to live in your fear about emotion, you will get angry very often. If you choose to start getting into your emotion, the actual causal emotion itself, and start allowing that emotion and deal with the blockages that are to experiencing that emotion, which are all fear-based blockages, then you will rarely get angry during this process. But it's your choice. Now, please bear in mind with all of that discussion that I've just done, that I'm not talking about the childhood anger. I'm talking about the anger that you get into as an adult and what you experienced as an adult. When you get into the childhood anger and allow yourself to experience the childhood anger, you will often be like a child when you experience it. So you'll lay on the floor kicking and screaming, right? Or you'll go outside and bash something, yelling and screaming, just like a child would experience their anger. Then the key is still to drop underneath that and get into the causal emotion. Why was the child angry? Most of the time because it was punished for something else that happened that was sad, or, you know, lots of different reasons, really.
You're dropping in and out.
I'm dropping in and out. And maybe it's because of some batteries here, but we'll see. Does that make sense to everyone?
You're out now.
I'm out now. Time for a battery change for me, I think. And do you want to come up, Josh? Do you mind a high chair or a low chair?
Okay, just recently started touching on some anger stuff.
And it... Hang on.
So?
Yes.
Can you hear me now? Right now? I don't know, you might notice I've got a bit of a scratched voice from doing some screaming. So I've just touched on some of the adult anger. And my issue is, like you said, you can make the choice to not feel that adult anger. It feels impossible to go straight underneath that. And, yeah, like, how do you make that choice? Because I've been in this state of being totally angry as an adult, but it just seems impossible to drop in. It just seems like this, that, like, and I can, I'm aware that there's some sort of block about not being able to do this work, and like, you know, but I just...
Are you sure it's the adult anger that you're actually feeling?
Well, actually, maybe not, because, you know, the situation happened yesterday.
Yep. Can you describe the situation?
It's a lot to do with this anger I feel for my mother and the feminine. And it's it was triggered yesterday, and it was almost like irresistible to just direct that at her.
Yeah.
And I just had to like fight that and just run to the room, but I'm probably directing it as I'm going, because yeah. You know, that's what you do.
So you almost got into the trap of just giving her a barrage, whoever the trigger was.
Yeah.
Yep.
So instead of doing that, I just went into the room and got the pillow out.
Yeah. You can say it.
And so like, it was because she raised something that happened when I was younger.
Yeah.
That is not the cause, I know that. But I just really want to, you know, I want to get past, I don't want to have to go through this anger, and I don't know if I'm meant to feel that anger.
Well, when you allowed yourself to feel the anger, was there an emotion underneath that started coming up?
Yeah, I could feel that, but I just, because I don't know how you make the jump, like emotionally. Like,
yeah.
I can, okay, this is the real me, right?
Yeah.
And this isn't the real me, and I know I'm thinking, but how to, this is this, this big dilemma that, since I've been doing this work, is like, how the hell do I have control over my soul? I just don't seem to have any serious control over it.
Yep.
And
can you describe the emotion that you felt underneath the anger? Like, just, you would have felt it quite briefly while you were bashing
away. Yeah, it would have been grief.
Grief?
I feel like that.
Probably. What was it about? Can you remember?
Being blamed for her problem.
Okay. So being blamed for somebody else's problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it was something that was being done to me, but I was being blamed for it.
So now let yourself just step into that emotion. So what I do is I breathe and just go into the fact that I've been blamed all my life for somebody else's problem. And allow yourself to just step into that. So what I do is I feel my anger, you know, beat the pillow or whatever it is with a tennis racket or whatever. But then as soon as I can feel what the underlying emotion is, I just jump into that like jumping into a pool. Just allow myself to be immersed in the underlying emotion. Now, I can feel that underlying emotion just bubbling just under the surface.
Yeah, I can feel that, but I just, you know, like, because I'm visual, I keep thinking, okay, there's the pool, I'll happily jump in if I could to...
Okay, so the fact that you're not feeling that emotion, even though we can feel it inside of you, means that there must be another block to feeling it. So what would you like to do to your mum instead of feeling this emotion? So the instant that she blames you...
Oh, absolutely. I just would love to scream at her for it.
You would like to yell and scream? What else would you like to do? You could be honest.
Like, I that's the thing that came up yesterday was, like, naturally I just would say, you know, like, what's wrong with directly at her when I'm directing it anyway? Like, I felt like that would connect me up more, because the times that I've got to some grief is when I've been talking to her through these things.
Okay, so step back into your room and then say the thing you didn't say to her. Yell and scream it if you like. What would you yell and scream at her?
It'd be just like... And this is what happens, I'll get into this state where it's sort of like bubbling but there's no tears. Like, am
you're
I doing this
close.
Right?
You're getting close.
Am I doing this right?
Yeah, you're getting close. What would you say? Just go inside.
I'd say, it's not fair.
Yeah.
Why? Why are you playing this? Why? Oh, you know, I'm trying to make it happen and it's not coming.
Yeah, but just keep expressing yourself. You don't have to try. Just express it how you feel it. How you feel
it's just not fair. It's the way I feel. I feel the judgment of not being allowed to be childlike.
What's not fair?
So let's feel more about what's not fair.
It's not fair that you do all this for me and you blame that I do not do nothing. You've done it all for me, but...
But you want something back.
I just want her to get away from me. That's what, and, like, I'm not connected to her right now.
Now you're judging yourself.
Yeah.
You're getting very close to the connection, but as soon as you're getting close, you're judging yourself and saying, I'm not connected.
I guess there's a fear about little people being here and being exposed.
Yeah, and doing it in front of everybody.
And being vulnerable.
Yeah. So that's a fear that you'll be able to work through. But
the other question is, am I dealing with anything when I'm getting to that state where I can feel my stomach going like this and like that sort of thing and there's no tears coming?
Well, this is what would happen in your childhood. Every time you were blamed for things, you felt all this rage and you felt all this terror and you felt this anger and everything inside of you. It's just all locked up and it's got nowhere to go. So what it does is it starts coming out in your body, you know, and you shake and you tremor and your body, you know.
But is it important for me to feel those things or yes. Like I just want to get to the source of the problem?
No, you'll need to feel this because this is a locked up emotion from your childhood too. Does that make sense? This is how it got for you. This is how much anger there is inside. Like, because of being blamed for things that are not your fault.
Yeah.
And just let your body feel those feelings. And when you let your body feel them without judgment, you'll be able to then get into the deeper emotions. Does that make sense? It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter, like, anything. Just feel the emotion. Just let yourself feel the emotion. Let yourself feel what it was like to have to shut yourself down so much just to please your mother. Because that's what she wants. That's what she wants you to do. Shut you down so much. And she was giving you all of these things, but she wants a heap of things in return from you, and that feels bad to you. So allow yourself to connect with that. That's it. And as you connect to that, you will start really connecting. That's it. And as you connect, that's how much rage is there. You see, this is the childhood rage now. You see that? That's it. And this is the childhood rage that's still there. Let yourself feel it.
Yeah.
You feel that, right? And you can feel even just that little bit of release is better already, like. And now you'll start connecting to some sadness about that. You know, that rage, that childhood rage is what's capping the sadness about the situation. And that's how it works. That's how it works.
And still, I just don't feel like I'm done. Get it right. Get
you
it right.
Will, you know. At the moment, you've got 100 people at the front that you're conscious of, right?
Yeah.
You don't. when you're by yourself, you let yourself get into just that state you were feeling, you know, that shaking rage, and just let yourself get into that state and stay in that state and stay in that state and stay in that state. And even voice the words you feel in that state, because there may or may not be words associated with it, depending on how young all of these things began to occur. And then when you do that, you'll connect with the grief that's under it. So what you did just now is exactly what you need to do. And it's going to be a lot easier doing it without 100 people watching, obviously. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And, I guess, like, maybe it'd be easier if I just put it out there that if something like that happens when everyone's here, just if that's okay.
Yeah.
Because, like, I'm like, well, you're saying get in the anger, and, like, I'm thinking, all right, I feel this anger. Yeah, you know, I'd love to get up there and, you know, just get out and go straight in the anger, but everyone's going to see that
and judge that.
And then the cops will come again.
Last week, the cops came and visited us because there were quite a number of people in their anger. And yes, like, there are some ways, obviously, like the policeman suggested, a very angry policeman suggested that we all go into our room and scream into a pillow. But that's not always possible. And the key is just to allow yourself to express it. And if a policeman comes along and says, what went on, I just experienced some anger. Am I not allowed to do that? And just allow yourself to express what's going on still. I know that there is judgment, you know, there's always a judgment. So even when Josh was feeling that emotion, many of you had some worries, had some judgment. Could you feel that judgment inside of you? What were you feeling?
I was worried he was going to drop the mic.
Well, who cares about the mic? I don't care, right? What other judgments? Fear about how bad this might get, how bad this might finish up looking, right? What might happen to Josh? You know, a lot of you started feeling, that's your own fear. That's your own fear about dealing with your own emotions, in fact. Does that make sense? These are all these blockages. So yeah, what you've done today is just show how much the rage is. And when you start feeling that childhood rage, that's what it will be like. And in your case, it was shut down so much from your environment that it's now inside you like this silent shaking. And you will go through that emotion in order to get to what the grief is underneath. So allow that to happen. And your mum or whoever the woman is triggering you will trigger you. Do that. Let yourself go into that. And if they get into a state of judgment about it, leave that house, find another house and do it there. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Don't allow anyone to shut you down anymore with these emotions.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
I'll do this for another 20 minutes, then I'll sort out my wiring problem. So I'll just disconnect myself again. When we get angry, by the way, and feel anger, you'll find that lots of things around you, if you deny emotions, lots of things around you will start breaking. And I mean, like electronic things won't work anymore. There'll be all sorts of effects you'll find if you start allowing yourself to feel some of these emotions. The key is just to go into them and let yourself feel them right back to the causal level. When you do that, what will happen is everything will start coming back alive again. We've had computers break and all sorts of things, and then next day they're fine and all sorts of things happen like that. My own car broke down in a similar sort of event of the denial of emotion. So you can find that there's a lot of things linked, in fact, to you experiencing your emotions. One thing I'd just like to say, thank you very much, Josh, for that. Most of us have that intensity of unexpressed rage and anger within us that we're not allowing ourselves to connect to and feel. Now, at some point, you will need to allow yourself to connect and feel to it, and feel into it, and when you do, you'll drop in to what's underneath it. And so could you see, initially, when Josh wanted to say those things to his mum, you know, how dare you blame me for things that are in your life, that's the adult in the rage. Can you see that? When he started allowing himself to drop further down into it and became the shaking man, that's the child in its rage that was suppressed. Can you see the difference between the two? One of them was the projection at the mother. The other one was actually the ownership of this rage within and getting into the rage within, connecting to that. Once he starts dropping even further into that, you notice, Josh, that even some of the sadness starts to be present then when you start dropping that far down. And you'll find that you might take a few attempts, but you'll get to the cause quite rapidly. And because you're quite young, you haven't got as many layers of suppression that many of us who are 40 or 50 or 60 have. And so, therefore, you know, it's a bit easier for you to do that. For those of us that are a bit older, you may find it takes a bit longer to step into that stage of dropping down into those emotions.
71 tomorrow.
71 tomorrow, yeah. So obviously there's 71 years of suppression, unfortunately. Yeah. And you've made some shifts, obviously, in your... And probably this is a good time to invite you up, actually. So come on. Bring your bag of goodies. Can you bring your bag of goodies? Ian's got a bag of goodies. And I just want to show you his bag of goodies. So this is what Ian's started to carry around with him now.
This is my rage pack.
He calls it his rage pack. So if Ian can just show you what's in his rage pack, and he explains how he uses his rage pack.
This,
This is the centre of it. This rubber hose, you can see it. It's had quite a lot of use, but I think it's got a lot more use to go yet.
So, rubber hose for beating things with, just not your partner.
Right? No, on this telephone book.
Right.
And I'll get that down on the floor.
So we'll take this other one, because this is another rage pack thing.
No, it's all part of it.
This is all part of the rage pack. This is a very practical part of your rage pack.
Rubber.
Gloves, so that you don't hurt your hands.
My hands.
All right? Trust me. You're going to want some gloves. All right?
I do this on a mattress on the floor, so I just...
So he does it on a mattress on the floor?
And I try not to make too much sound.
No, make as much sound as you want.
All right.
We'll be right, I think, with the police.
So it's with the rubber glove, not
so
rubber
you generally
gloves.
Kneel down on the
gardening
floor.
Gloves.
You kneel down on the floor generally?
I'm on a mattress.
On a mattress?
To protect me. So I can lie on the mattress, I can roll over on the mattress, I can scream on the mattress, those sort of things.
Now, for some of you, having the gloves might be a problem if they're a bit take too long to put on and take off. Because generally I find when I get into anger, you generally want to express it straight away. So.
And I the person that I'm, whatever I'm angry with, into the telephone book and aim at the telephone book. So it could be you. Etc.
You get the idea? Just connect to that.
If I want to vary it a little, I can. Oh, shit.
What he's doing is ripping out the pages of the table.
And sometimes you look at an ad in the.
Sometimes he says you find the ad that you want.
Trigger me all the fair modern picture framing. Now that's exactly what it was about.
So a lot of times his law of attraction is exactly what he sees in the framework is exactly what he's angry about.
So that's a debit death. And the towel's useful. Like
ringing
if you want to wring somebody's neck, you can really screw it up. Put all this out.
Alright.
And another tool is a mirror. Having a mirror beside and talk to the person in the mirror.
So talking to
which is a part of myself I'm talking to.
Yeah.
Another one is a pillow. And put the person, particularly with grief, is put the person in the pillow and talk to the person in the, that often bring up grief.
Yeah.
What about on the road when it's raining? You never get mad. What do you do then?
Stop the car. Take the key out of the ignition, and hold the steering wheel and give it to the steering wheel.
Yeah. Yeah.
And cars very soundproof. And if you turn the music up too, if you want to particularly deaden the sound.
Triple M or something. Is it triple J or whatever you say?
Really, really. Really loud. And at home too, turn up the music. It's a good idea if you feel the neighbours are going to hear you.
Yeah. So when you walk into Ian's home and you hear his music blaring, and you hear this thud, 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 thud with a few swear words in it, you know what he's doing.
And I'd like to give thanks to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who gave me all these tools.
Yeah. And can you just explain, Ian, this is a lady, there's a lady called Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who has since passed, by the way, and who is now on the Divine Love Path, I think. And she was very, very interested in helping people deal with emotional processing. And she was also very interested in spirit connection as well. And how Ian learned some of these techniques was through her.
Through some of the workshops.
And he's feeling her now, actually, because she's here right at the moment.
And some of the staff members, Eddie Reed has passed on, and David.
So there's different
David
staff.
Mullins.
Different staff
and staff members that helped me a lot.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Ian.
Pleased to share that with you. I hope you can pay fine new use for your telephone book.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, man. Now, the key is not to stay in the anger. So remember that. The key isn't to stay in the anger. It's to express the anger and drop down. Like, if you stay in the anger, you're going to find this a very damaging process rather than a very helpful one. We need to drop down into the underlying causal emotion. That's what the object of this exercise is. We want to get this anger out of us, and the only way it's going to come out of us, if it's a childhood rage or anger, is experiencing it. If it's an adult anger and rage, that's something I want to talk about in a minute about adult anger and rage. So after the break that we have, I'll talk about adult anger and rage and what we need to do with that and what's actually happening there. So here, bear in mind, what we're talking about is this childhood anger and rage and how to connect with it and then how to just allow it to be released in a safe way so you're not damaging other people. Thanks, Ian. Right up the back. He was right up the back. Say your name to everyone.
My name's Andrew. What happens if your fear of your emotions is greater than your desire to feel them?
And then you'll never feel them.
So how would you get around that?
And I was in that state for a lot of my life. So the way I had to work through that is, firstly, if your fear of emotions is greater than your desire to experience them, the first thing you need to start understanding, even at an intellectual level, is that the fear is the false expectations that appear real to you, not what is really going to happen. So most of us have some really, really strong false expectations about how bad it's going to get emotionally. So, for example, for many of you, if you feel like you allow yourself get into your anger, what are you afraid of? Now, for some, we'll say, oh, I'm afraid of hurting someone, judgment. Or you're afraid of judgment for yourself. So that's the next layer that you need to deal with before you get into your anger and before you get into the sadness. There's this blocking emotion of a fear of judgment. So what I would do then is I would pray to God about people judging me. Is it right? Should I accept it? How do I feel inside about judgment? And connect to some of the feelings inside that you have about others judging you through your life. And you'll need to connect to it emotionally for it to be released. Now, when you allow yourself to feel the fear of judgment and release that, then you'll also allow yourself to feel the anger that's the childhood anger that's there. Does that make sense? So your fear of judgment is the capping emotion over the top of you allowing yourself to experience the anger. Yeah. Now, for every person here, it will be a different fear or multiple ones. For some, it will be fear of punishment. For some, it's fear of judgment. Some, it will be fear of rejection. You know what I mean? It just depends on what emotions we were brought up on through our family life as to what particular dominant emotions they'll be that are blocking us from experiencing our anger. And so the key is to allow yourself firstly to hone in on that emotion. So to revise, all we need to do is say, all right, I know there's anger and rage within me, but I'm afraid of experiencing it. And all we need to do is ask ourselves the question, why? And write down all the reasons why you're afraid of experiencing your anger. And then they are the next group of emotions for you to pray about, and they are the next group of emotions for you to actually allow yourself to feel about. So what I do then is I write about it every day. I'll write something about it, or I'll pray to God about it every single day as well. And I'll talk about it in my conversations with others. You know, I'm really afraid of experiencing my anger because every time I have in the past, I've been judged for it as bad or, you know, whatever the emotion was. Or it might be, you know, I'm really afraid of experiencing my anger and feeling my anger because I think you're not going to love me if I'm angry. Whatever the block is, talk about that block. And in talking about the block and allowing yourself to begin feeling, in your case, the judgment will lower, it will go down, And as that judgment goes down inside of yourself, your fear of the judgment releases. And as the fear of the judgment releases, you'll find the underlying emotion will become, it'll feel like it's becoming more dominant, and you'll start experiencing the underlying emotion. The reality is that the judgment is a bigger emotion inside of you at that moment than the other emotion is. So that's why you need to feel that one first. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. You got another question?
No.
No worries. Thank you. So does everyone understand what I just said there? Often there will be layers of capping emotions on top of even an experience of anger. And often what we're dealing with, and in fact the most difficult emotions you will ever have to deal with in your entire life, are going to be the emotions that shut down all the other emotions, or what I would call the blockages. Releasing the blockages is one of the most difficult tasks that you face. And it has been my most difficult problem all through my own progression. Because once I release the capping emotions, the other emotions just flow like a child. So it's quite easy to access the underlying emotions, but it's the capping emotions, and judgment is one of them, fear of rejection, fear of punishment, and quite a lot of other types of emotions like that. They are the reasons why we shut ourselves down. And we need to start being even honest and truthful about the reasons. Once we feel that, talk about it with each other. You know, this is how I feel in this situation, this is how I feel in that situation. Start talking about the emotions that are blocking you. Then the fear of the blockages will start releasing inside of you, and the emotion that you're blocking will feel like it's growing, but in reality, it's becoming exposed. So it's a bit like, let's say you were digging a hole and there's a bit of treasure under the ground. And this is what your soul is really like. If you can think of your soul as a $5 million treasure in your backyard, the trouble is you don't know where it's buried. This is how we often start, right, with our emotions. Often when we start, we do not know where our soul even is, let alone experiencing it. But if you were told there was a $5 million, block of gold in your backyard, wouldn't you start digging everywhere? Can you do that? And do you think you'd say, oh no, there's a good telly show today, I'll put it off till tomorrow. And do you think you'd then go, oh no, you know, there's a really good movie I can see down the picture theatre, so I'll go there today. Oh no, but there's some mates coming over, so I'll just stop doing it then. And you wouldn't do this, would you? If there was this $5 million block of gold in your backyard, well, your soul's more precious than that. So why do you stop digging? Right? So we need to make sure we dig. So when we start digging, what happens? Eventually, the treasure starts to show itself, does it not?
Yeah.
But it's like just the pinnacle of the treasure, isn't it? We just see the tip of the iceberg as we dig. And this is also what it's like with your emotions. As you start digging around and probing around inside of you emotionally, initially, what you will see is just a little bits here and there. But as you dig more and as you dig more, it'll become wider and wider until you see the whole thing. And so when you get a fair way along this journey of allowing your emotions and releasing the blockages, you'll become very conscious of what emotions are within you. And you'll be able to see them very clearly. You won't feel judgment for them anymore. And you'll be very free to talk about them with anybody you meet. And you will allow yourself to begin experiencing them. And that's what we all need to do. But we all need to do it for ourselves. We can't rely on other people to do this for us. And that's where it's so important. You need to have that passionate desire, just like you would if you were told there was some treasure in your backyard. Now there's one thing I'd like to talk to everyone about first, before we do any more of this anger discussion. I'm feeling a huge amount of resistance about this subject from the audience. And I'm feeling that the majority of you feel you do not have anger to deal with. You can't hear back there. It's on pretty loud. Sorry, it's probably lots of background noise back there. Can you hear me now?
trouble is I've got to adjust it carefully so that it doesn't ring as well. When I discuss subjects with an audience, generally there's a general feel from the audience. Some of the subjects that we've discussed in the past, you will have noticed the audience sort of goes through these feeling phases. Do you remember when we did the law of compensation discussion? You remember how there was this real heavy, depressed sort of feeling that the majority of the audience felt during that discussion? And many of you went to sleep during it. It says a lot for me, though. And quite a few of you felt very tired and exhausted and overwhelmed and everything. And then when I started to address the spirits who were with us and talk to the spirits about how they were feeling and talk to you about how you were feeling about the law of compensation, all of a sudden things started to raise again. I don't know if you remember that, but that was the general feeling in the audience. What's happening today is that many of you believe inside of your hearts that you do not have an issue with anger. Right? Many of you feel that you're over that you don't have any problems with that you live a pretty good life and all those kind of things, and your law of attraction pretty good, and no, I don't have an issue with anger. And I'm telling you bluntly, you do. Now, you can disbelieve me all you like. That's fine. That's your call. But I can feel the projections of anger from you. So whether you want to do something about it or not, it's up to you. But I'm telling you categorically, if you do not deal with this emotion, and if you don't face up to the truth about what you feel inside of yourself, you will not get closer to God. Is that what you want? Do you remember in the discussion with the spirits that I played, how I said to them what they would need to do to get beyond their anger? Remember, they had to get beyond their anger into their grief and their sadness. Remember that? And remember the first thing that they said? Oh, no, I don't want to do it now. Like, before we were talking about being in the nice place, and they said, yes, 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 I want to be in the nice place. And then as soon as I say what they needed to do to get to the nice place, what did they then say? No, I don't want to do that. Right? And this is the problem we all face. We face this issue inside of ourselves. Are we willing to really be honest about what's inside of us? Because if you're not, then you might as well give up the divine love path. Because you're going to find a lot of traumatic experiences on that path if you don't want to be honest and truthful about how you really are inside of yourself. So allow yourself to have a good look at what's inside of yourself rather than just denying it. Now, there's so many of you who feel you're not angry, and yet I can feel the anger coming from you, but just sitting in the audience. But you don't want to know. Many of you feel that you do not want to know. But that's okay. That's your free will. But there's a part of your soul, obviously, that's saying the opposite. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here having a discussion about anger, right? So let yourself start to realise what's going on inside of you. Are you feeling resistive to this discussion? Are you feeling this discussion doesn't apply to you? Because if you are, then it applies to you. Because the resistance is proof of what is inside, generally. You don't get away with it, do you?
Just trying to adjust it.
I was just going to point out that when I first started dealing with my emotions, I didn't realise how angry I was. And Paula and I wrote up on the board in the break, Paula and I have a new motto, and it is always sweat the small stuff, because it's actually the small stuff that has led me to really huge emotions inside of myself. So if I get irritated about a phone call, or if AJ doesn't, do the drying up, there's a huge emotion underneath that. But we're very well trained in just skipping over those things. Oh, that's what happens when you live with someone. Oh, well, you know, or we're very good at empathising with the other person and saying, oh, I understand why they're like that. But in the end, we actually skip over what the deep hurt is within us.
Do you want to give an example of it?
Can you think of one?
I can think of a better 100 dozen. trouble with trouble is that every example I think of, you seem to get angry with.
Test me out, see if I work through an emotion.
When we the very first time we met, it was about a year and a quarter ago or so, and we met in Mary's mother and father's home. And Mary, we started having a discussion, but my problem was I was tongue-tied, and so she didn't get much out of me, right, in terms of a discussion.
I didn't know why it wouldn't talk to me.
And
why
so...
No.
No, you know, like, I'm just blown away by this lady, so how can I solve them? Like, that's the way I feel. But Mary felt quite annoyed at that. Yeah.
Yeah. See, I didn't know.
And it was one of these emotions that were coming up for Mary that she didn't notice at the time, but now is quite large for her, and that is an emotion of this person doesn't want to hear me, doesn't want to interact with me, doesn't want to really know who I am. That was the emotion that was triggered in her right in that instant. But all I felt was a bit of annoyance coming from her, and she wouldn't have hardly even noticed that emotion at the time. Then a week or two after that, she was very angry then. What was that about then?
I went to another group of AJs and he was talking about being Jesus, and he was talking about some of the pageant messages written about the celestial heavens closing, and I thought, what is going on here? There's some kind of, you know, foreign brimstone person lurking in there, and I was very afraid. And I actually... the emotions I was avoiding was a lot of deep hurt that I have about organised religion and what that has done on the planet for a long time. But I had some fear on top of that, that that's what he was on about. And instead of feeling the fear or even feeling the hurt or even the fear, I went straight into anger and projected. I think Ange was at that meeting and Helbert, you'll remember.
So... what we've found in our own relationship is that there are times when we have a very small discussion about something that has huge emotions under it. Another time was we had a visitor over, a friend of Mary's from Switzerland, and we were just deciding how to set out our lounge room for visitors. And do you want to describe the event?
I can't even remember the exact events. But my friend, Megan, who'll probably watch this, was just sitting there very bemused because we started out talking about pillowcases and 5 minutes later I was talking about feeling disempowered as a woman and AJ was feeling about having his needs never being met and she didn't quite know what was happening.
So what had happened within a few weeks of Mary coming to live with me, I just wanted a certain thing to happen with these pillows, right? And it's the only thing I've ever asked in that entire time. And so my feeling was, the one thing I want done my way, it can't be done my way. And Mary's feeling for it.
I'm totally out of control. I'm in a new environment. I want this to be my home too. You know, men never listen to me. I'm completely disempowered.
Yeah. So I spent the rest of the afternoon crying on the roof, cleaning out the gutter. And Mary spent about half an hour or so in the room in an anger state. And then we came down and had a chat to poor old Megan, who was sitting there.
She's pretty easygoing.
So, can you see how just a tiny little thing, there can be some really large emotions? And the key is not to overlook anything intellectually. See, what we often do, and this is one thing that this discussion brings up, is that in the outline I've got that you have afterwards or being sent to you, is we often intellectually choose to skip over really, really huge stuff. And we go through this process of justification all the time. And that's the major problem that we face, this process of justification that we go through. In the case of many of us, we're so used to intellectualizing that it didn't matter, that in reality we just skip over huge emotions. Now, I've seen many people do this over and over and over again, saying to themselves, oh, that didn't matter, that was just a little issue. And inside of it, I just feel that this huge mountain of emotions there, in them, in that particular issue, that they're just suppressed with that one little comment of, oh, it didn't matter, or whatever it was that they're saying. So the truth is, with all this adult anger, you can see it as your guide, or you can just make out it's not there. That's your call. But understand, when you make that call, you're also making a choice. You're making the choice to stay alienated from God, and also the choice to stay alienated from your own self, because you're not allowing yourself to feel what you truly feel. So there's been many times where Mary and I have had just a tiny little thing happen, and it's blown into a really large thing, in the sense that there's huge emotions around it. So, I don't know if you want me to mention too many of them, because you might be embarrassed. And maybe if I can mention a few of mine, and that way you won't be so embarrassed. Yeah, Mary has had a lot of anger to work her way through, primarily with me.
When I first met AJ, I really thought I was not an angry person at all. I was known to be, I think my mother used to call me serene. And when I met AJ, and I was on the later part of the trip that Ange was on for a couple of months, I have never been so angry in my entire life. All of it very quiet and very seething, but of course that doesn't stop him feeling the brunt of it. And that was because I was in extreme amounts of fear about what was happening, and I just didn't want to feel it. So I was just projecting it all onto AJ. All the while going, I'm not very angry.
Yeah. So I would say, Mary, you're angry. What's this about? And the first comment generally for Mary was, oh, I'm not angry.
I didn't feel angry, I just felt like, oh, I want space, I want, you know, I want control. But really, if we scratched the surface as soon as we started discussing it, I was suddenly feeling a lot of anger.
Yeah. So if you're having an emotion of, I want space from somebody, very highly likely there's a lot of anger in there, right? If you're looking for space from somebody. So the truth is that in reality, what will happen when your soul is in a pristine condition, the moment you want space is the moment you have space anyway. So you won't even need to project anything to anybody. And secondly, why would you want space? Everything's passing through you. There's no resistance. So it doesn't matter where you are, you'll enjoy yourself. Whether you have space or whether you're in a 1,000 people environment, you're still going to enjoy yourself. So a lot of these things that we do are just ways to run away from what we're getting triggered in. Does that make sense to everyone? And in particular, usually it's running away from the anger we feel. But generally, even underneath that, there's a lot of other emotions. Was it 4 days after you came to England? That was when you had that memory, wasn't it? And if you can picture that Mary's coming to England because, by the way, in between, I should sort of explain for those that have never heard this before, Mary was very angry with me at the beginning. Then I went away overseas, and then somebody else told her that I felt that she was my soulmate. And by the way, I also felt that I'd never see her for quite a few years yet to come, because of how much there was that anger there, and how many other emotions that were there. So I didn't feel that there was any point in even saying to Mary, I feel you're my soulmate at that point. But then what happened was she was told by other people that I felt she was my soulmate. And so she then sent me an email saying, asking the details about that, which was almost an angry email too, wasn't it, in a way. And then a few months after we sort of start developing a relationship, because we start talking, we start getting along pretty well, things develop after that. We haven't been with each other yet. We've just still been talking over the phone from overseas, and writing emails to each other on the phone, talking to each other quite a lot. And then eventually Mary decides she's going to join me on the trip overseas, and just to see what this is all about. And 4 days
sort
into
you
it,
out, basically.
Yeah, sort of. the things she felt was that she wanted to show me that I wasn't Jesus, and pretty much. Yeah.
I wanted to show you I wasn't your soulmate.
But. And you weren't my soulmate, yeah. But by this stage, we were starting to get along pretty well. But 4 days into arriving overseas, she has this huge emotional memory, experience. So 4 days after meeting, for a day we didn't speak, right, to each other, because there was just so much anger. And so Mary has a lot of anger, which is like your childhood anger, about me, specifically about me and what I did in the first century and how she felt about that, through the filters of her parents this time around. And so Mary's had a lot of experience in dealing with these same emotions that you'll be working through in working through your anger-based emotions. And so she knows what it's like to go through what you're going through. That'd be accurate to say, I reckon. Because it's just the amount of anger we are in generally covers over the depth of the grief we feel. So if we are in a big rage, that demonstrates how big the sadness is underneath. Does that make sense? As the rage that's covering over the sadness. So if you can allow yourself to start seeing that actually there is a big area here to work your way through, and it's very important.
Could I just share one more thing before I get down? And that is about man anger. I also, before I started looking at my emotions or started on this path, didn't think that I was very angry with men. And I meet a lot of women who don't think they're very angry with men. But just about 90% of those women I can feel are very angry with men, because I'm starting to work through that emotion myself. And I think a lot of women on the planet today, there's been a lot of multi-generational hurt, and so we sort of have this attitude that, well, I'm a woman and my needs should be met, really, and if they're not, well, it's a man's problem. And that's actually a very angry attitude, because we're so afraid of being hurt again, we actually become quite aggressive. I had more I want to say about that, but I think
you were going to write an email about that, post that, at some point.
Yeah. When I finish with the emotion.
Can you give some more examples of, like, I need space, and that those little triggers that we might be able to watch out for? I thought that was a really helpful one for me personally.
Yeah.
So you're looking for the kind of things Mary has noticed herself doing
that, any of
that are covering over the anger.
Yeah.
Just any little irritation in the day where you know, just like AJ doesn't do something that I want, really. Like, he always makes my cup of tea in the morning and he doesn't make my cup of tea. So it's an irritation. Or just something that I would usually go, oh, I'll make my own cup of tea, but it's skipping over this little feeling inside of me.
One time at an airport, I didn't carry her heavy bag.
That's so embarrassing, because I'm such a liberated woman. Why would someone need to carry my bag? But he did it every other time, and he stopped that time.
I did it while we were travelling, and then this one time I didn't do it. And yeah, that triggered a lot of anger for Mary. There's been little things even, like, that I've noticed Mary doing as well. Things like trying to change the subject is a big thing. Or trying to intellectualise the subject is another big thing.
Justify my stance on anything. Yeah.
So, for instance, so shortly after myself and Mary met, we went shopping together for some food. We've told the story before. But Mary was very, very angry because I was going to buy some basil from Israel. And she felt really, really upset with me about that issue. And underneath that was a huge number of emotions for Mary about first century life that still is still working through now, isn't it? Like, so just that one act of being upset with me doing something that she wouldn't normally do. Yeah.
I guess control, like whenever I feel like I need to be in control more, it's usually,
And she'll often not state to me what she wants me to do. She'll often ask me the question, but it's an implied thing that she wants me to do. Like, does that make sense? And so many of you women I've noticed do exactly the same thing. And where you ask the other person a question, but really what you're saying is, I want you to do that, please, right? And that happens quite often. And instead of coming out and saying, I want you to do that for me, and then having to get rejected of no, I'm not, we often go down this track of saying, oh, would you like that instead, you know? And I find nowadays, and I said this to the group in the car, I think it was on the way here today, nowadays I'm finding that there is lots and lots of layers of emotion under our that are over the top of our true feelings. And what Mary and I have found is by staying in the interaction with each other, we stay in that emotion until we find the bottom of the feeling.
It's very powerful if every person is owning their emotion and not project, like not blaming. We, like the pillowcase thing, we really got very deep very quickly.
And I just thought of another example that just passed my mind. Anyway, it'll come to me, I'm sure. But where we often find these little tiny events blow up into these huge emotions. Not that they blow up in the sense of me and Mary arguing with each other, but they blow up in the sense of me getting into a major causal emotion and crying for quite a few hours, or Mary doing that. And just if you choose to own your emotion in these transactions, you'll find you'll rapidly work through issues when you're with a partner. Because remember, the law of attraction has brought you and your partner, if you have one, together. So therefore, the law of attraction is there to expose these emotions. If you deny the law of attraction and say, well, you're not doing what I want, or she's, or I'm not doing what you want, and we walk away from each other, then we get away from what's actually drawing us together in the first place, and we're not dealing with those emotions. So let yourself access the emotions that are underneath. And that's going to mean working through layers of anger. So in a partnership or a relationship, you'll find that there will be issues between each other as a result. So my issue, for example, is that I have a lot of issues, and I've had a lot of issues, less now, about pleasing women. And all a woman has to do is just project a need at me for something, and I'll instantly fulfill it without even asking her, like, what it is, because I know what it is. I can feel it coming from her, and I just do it straight away. And I've done that all my life, right? And so over the last nearly 2 years, I've been breaking through that and into these emotions of, no, is this a loving thing for me to be doing? And a lot of times it hasn't been. And the reason why I've been trying to do it is because I just want to please the woman. Right? I just want to get a nice emotion from her if she's being happy with me. And that's often meant that I've attracted a woman who's not happy with me unless I'm doing exactly what she wants. Does that make sense? And so then I've had to work through those emotions of, so I've had these feelings sometimes of Mary, this annoyance that she wants me to do things for me, that she wants to do me to do things for her that she would not be willing to do for me. And I've had to feel that emotion of, wow, you know, this is not right, this is unequal, you know, this is not the right thing for me to be doing. And then I've had to feel the emotion of, what is Mary going to do if I say no? You know, what, you know, I'm probably going to lose her, and I don't want to lose her. I only just met my soulmate after 45 years. Do you think I want to lose her? Of course not. And so I've had to work through all of that emotion of staying in truth, whether I lose Mary or not. And that's been really, really triggering for me, and I've had to work through quite a lot of emotions about that. Does that make sense? So, getting back to the anger though, the anger just is amazing. What I find is mild irritant, mild annoyance, mild anything covers a mountain of emotion. A mountain of emotion. So every time you cover over mild annoyance and mild irritation or mild frustration, you're actually denying for yourself an opportunity to deal with a mountain of emotion.
And most people don't even feel mild irritation. We're so trained in intellectually skipping over it. We don't even realise a lot of the time that we are actually irritated or annoyed, or it's very fleeting.
Yeah. So ask people, do you feel I'm angry? Ask somebody else, do you feel anger from me? You know, let yourself ask that question of others. Often, you know, often we don't want to know what other people feel about us, and that's why we project emotions at them, because we don't want to know what they got to say. But often they can tell us a lot of things. So I've had to ask people, do you feel I'm angry at this point, or do you feel I'm sad, or what are you feeling? And when Mary says, you're angry, and I know I'm angry, I say, yeah, I'm angry, all right.
They're coming.
Not much to today, but can you see how important it is to work through issues emotionally together? Because if Mary and I split up just because of one thing that came up, what would happen is all the other things that could have come up after that we now are not dealing with. Now, I'm not suggesting to stay in an abusive situation. So, for example, if I get angry at Mary, right, and I project anger at her, and she then addresses that anger with me, and I don't want to own that emotion, and I just get angry back at Mary, and then she tries to address it with me, and then I get angry back at Mary again, now the situation's abusive. You don't need to stay in abusive situations. And if you are staying in a situation like that, you've got very big emotional injuries that are causing you to stay there because you're not loving you. Does that make sense? So allow yourself to feel that. But stay, if I get angry with Mary, and Mary says, you're angry with me, and please, you know, go into the emotion and deal with the emotion, and I start getting into the emotion, now she has a good reason to stick in the relationship because I'm actually now dealing with the emotion. And if I deal with the emotion and get to the core, I'm not going to be angry with her about that issue ever again. So that's going to be very, very helpful for our relationship. But so obviously we're none of us are perfect yet, right? We can't expect each other to never be angry, right? But if someone's getting angry about the same issue over and over again, then that's abusive. And it's time to do something about it. We need to do something about it in those situations. Does that make sense very well?
AJ, in a situation like that where like your injuries start bouncing off each other and it gets a little bit overwhelming, using your example, is it at that point okay to say, I need space because it's not loving? Because I've just had a trigger like that where it was just coming at me, but I've consciously chosen to take space from my friends so that I could process what I was going through.
Sure.
Aware that I had anger and stuff.
Sure.
That's a more loving thing to do rather than...
Yeah, but don't write off the relationship.
No, not at all.
Don't do that. You go back into the relationship to see whether you've dealt with it. And there's a nice quote in The Way of the Heart that I talk about. I said there, you don't get to leave the room when the shouting begins. So on the Divine Love path, you don't get to leave the room when the shouting begins. See, on the natural love path, you know what you would do? You would just leave the room and make out, now it's diffused, now the problem, I'll wait a few days and it's going to be gone. Right? No, it doesn't go that way. It goes by you feeling all of your emotion and your partner feeling all of their emotion. Don't leave the room when the shouting begins, but don't keep shouting, blaming the other person. You know, if you're going to shout, feel your anger, but don't start projecting it. And that's what I want to talk about with you for the next hour or so, is how to actually deal with this adult anger that you're feeling. Right. That's what we're going to talk about. Dennis, you want to ask a question?
Yes. When you're in this ego and trying to deal with this pain, how do you find the courage? Where do you get this courage from to go into it?
So the question was, where do we get the courage from to go into our pain? Because really that's what all anger is about. All anger is about not wanting to go into our pain. So where do we get the courage to go into our pain? The only way I've gotten the courage is by talking to God and actually learning about truth. What's the truth of this situation? Remember, it's the truth that sets you free. So a lot of people think it's love that sets you free. But love comes to you when truth sets you free. Right? So the truth is a very, very important factor in all of this. The truth is what destroys all fear. Remember fear, you can think of fear as the false expectations or false emotions appearing real to you. So the truth is that everything you're afraid of, including your anger, you have some false beliefs about it. For instance, many of you might believe if you experience your anger or rage that you might hurt somebody. Well, you don't have to hurt somebody, but you believe you might. So that's a false expectation you have about getting into your anger. The truth will always destroy false expectations. So allow yourself to feel the truth. And when you feel the truth and talk to God about having the courage to face truth, you automatically start facing your emotions as a subsequent result. And God gives us courage through lots of means, but one of the greatest means is by exposing truth to us. When we know the truth, then fear means nothing. So, for instance, many of you may be afraid of death in the sense that if you went along to a funeral of your husband or wife, that you'd cry. If you'd go along to a funeral that you're going to cry, then you're afraid of something, right? So you need to face those fears. The truth about that, if it's entered your heart, will destroy all fear. And it's the truth about everything that destroys all fear. And therefore, since fear or the denial of fear is the creator of anger, obviously the truth also will have the effect of destroying the anger. So in a way, the anger is a guide into truth. The anger is telling you when you're not being truthful with yourself. Can you see that? The anger is telling you when you're not being truthful with yourself. The anger is telling you when you're not being humble. Remember, we defined humility as the desire, the passionate desire to experience all of your own emotions. If I'm angry, I don't have a passionate desire to experience all of my own emotions because the anger is there to cover over an emotion. Right? So, as soon as I'm angry, I know I'm not being humble. As soon as I'm angry, I know I'm not in truth. So anger is fantastic because it tells you straight away when you're in error. Straight away, the instant you feel even the tiny, mildest of annoyances, you are now in error and you know it if you acknowledge that that annoyance was there. But if you don't acknowledge that annoyance was there, you're not going to acknowledge the truth that you're actually covering over a large emotion. So therefore, you'll never experience that large emotion and get closer to God. Does that make sense to everyone? That's why it's so important to deal with your anger. Yeah. So the question. Right. So the question is there such a thing as justifiable anger? No. Okay. The same way as you deal with all other anger. Can I just clarify the no, the justifiable anger? Even if your daughter got raped right in front of your eyes, your anger is not justified. Even if your husband got murdered right in front of your eyes, your anger is not justified. Now, they're pretty strong statements, aren't they? But I mean what I say. Your anger is not justified in those circumstances. What is the anger? It is your choice to get away from your true emotion in that particular situation. So what would be your true emotion in a situation where your husband gets murdered right in front of your eyes? Fear, devastation, grief, all sorts of emotions would be there, wouldn't they? And you can feel them in that instant. In fact, when you become one with God, you will feel them in that instant. And we can't hear you.
Yeah, so something that's more removed. So you're about injustice in the world? Yeah. So.
Yep.
Yep.
When all the white schools get funded, the Aboriginal school doesn't get funded.
Yep. You've got a lot of grief about it. It's very sad. Yeah. And that's, I relate to this because I have had and still have some anger about injustice in the world, but I've learned two big things about it. One is that I have massive amounts of grief about it, and when I'm angry, I'm actually choosing not to feel the grief, because I have some emotions in me about being treated very unjustly in my life. And that's probably why I'm so hesitant to feel about the injustice. The other thing is that in the world today, we're so hooked on justice. It's all about the justice. And a really big, important thing that I learned was something that the slave spirits learned, and that's about God. If we actually have faith and trust in God as being a loving God, and that the laws of God are actually loving, even though at times we feel like it's not. If we build a relationship with God, those things become clear.
You know, Mahatma Gandhi, when he was on earth, said, an eye for an eye makes the whole world divide. And to me, that's a huge statement, because what it does is it tells you that raw justice, as what it's portrayed in the world today, is not going to work. Because there's so many things that have happened on this earth today that are unjust and unloving, that if we perpetuate the injustice, we just create more injustice. So if you have a feeling you're what I would call the angry activist. What I mean by that is the person who feels angry about the external things to themselves going on in the world. And as Mary just pointed out to you, Mary feels exactly the same way as this. Now, what that is driving is some very deep personal emotions of hurt within yourself that you are using these external events to cover over. And the key for you is to allow yourself to start feeling the personal emotion you feel about your own life that these events are triggering. Do you understand what I'm saying by that? So in other words, let's say you notice something external to yourself unjust. Oh, the politicians raised my tax and then went on a holiday. Now that feels unjust. So if I'm in the political scene and I'm looking at the political scene, I feel there's a deep injustice in that. But in reality, that's just connecting to some deep injustice in my own life, in my own childhood. And what I'm doing is externalizing my anger. I'm looking for something outside of myself to blame, so that I don't have to feel my own hurt about my own life in that situation. Does that make sense? The irony is that when I choose to feel my own hurt in my own life, you'll find that that will actually finish up lessening even the external event at the soul level. But the reason why is that at the moment, if I don't choose to feel my own anger, I am projecting anger on the world and making the world a more angry place, not a less angry place.
All the anger projected like that is actually an aggression. It's actually damaging to the whole planet. Me included, being angry about all of this injustice. And the way God has designed it is that if we do deal with this stuff within ourselves, it does have an impact on everything around us. And really, only when we're in a true state of love, in harmony with God, that's the only way we're going to change any of these things. Because there is injustice in the world, for sure. But by being angry, we're actually wanting to punish in that emotion.
And if you think about our anger generally is driven by this desire to blame, desire to punish, desire... We think it's a desire to make things better, but actually, because we have this desire within us to blame or punish, we're actually right at that moment making it even worse than it is, not better than it could be. So that's a major issue that we're facing.
AJ, what about things like the Martin Luther King protest and the Gandhi's passive resistance that appear to have had very positive outcomes in society?
The beauty of passive resistance is that you're stating your case without violence. Now, the only problem with passive resistance needs to come from the heart, not from the action. So not just from the action. So if we could get a whole group of very angry people together, educate them more into intellectually passively resisting something,
And they can go and passively resist it and maybe even accomplish something out of that. But if the passive resistance doesn't come from their heart, they are still damaging the situation. Does that make sense? Remember, every single discussion I've ever had with you, we've talked about the soul. Remember, it's the soul that is the real you. So if inside of my soul I have anger towards something external to me, but I make out it's not there and I act differently to that anger, that doesn't change the fact that this projection of emotion is coming from me to the universe. Can you see that? It doesn't change that. To actually truly change on the divine path, this anger that exists within me needs to be eradicated. The only way to eradicate it is going to be to feel it, firstly, then to dig deeper under it to find what the cause is under it and to feel that. And when I feel that and release that, that anger will no longer exist inside of me. That's when I have the most power in a passive resistive type thing in terms of changing the world. Because there is no anger in me generating it. And in fact, the irony is in that point, you won't even need to have passive resistance because your own soul condition will be in such a place of love that everything around you will just be attracted to that and change will happen automatically in a positive way rather than in a resistive way. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So while those methods make a lot of sense on the natural love path, they don't make much sense when we're on the divine love path. On the divine love path, remember, the focus is change yourself at the heart level first. Change yourself at the heart level first. Everything around you will change once you start doing that. Everything around you. And it will be so rapid, you'll notice it on a daily basis, just change is happening. When I was away with you over on Stradbroke Island, you saw me go through quite a lot of emotions. In fact, I think pretty much every day I was up in the room at some point crying for some reason, whatever it was. You saw me work through an emotion of with regard to money and the world's financial situation. And that took me a few hours to process. And instantly after that, my law of attraction regarding money instantly changed. After that. That's what happens with any time you make a change at the soul level, you have an instant reflection in the changes. Every single time. If you haven't had an instant change, then you haven't dealt with the causal emotion. Because as soon as the way God made the universe is the instant you deal with the causal emotion, the instant a change will happen in your life. So if that's the case, then this passive resistance, which is a slow, drawn-out opposition sort of thing, would never even need to occur. And imagine if every single one of us changed our attitude towards money right now. Like we dealt with the emotion, which in my case meant crying for quite a few days. So it might not be right now, it might be 3 days that I've finished dealing with it. But if everyone here did it, imagine the change that would occur just for all of our lives. There would just be huge changes in our life. We'd no longer value money like we value it. At the moment, many of us still value money above almost everything else. Right? And we would no longer do that. Right? We would no longer be in these states where we're needy for funds. And ironically, that's the time when everything will just start coming to us. Because we've got lots of opposition to that occurring in the soul. So imagine that multiplied by every issue here. Every issue we're facing, we all just dealt with at the causal level, then there's no need for us to go out and protest something because we've just dealt with everything inside of us at the causal level. Something I said in the Way of the Heart is just to make sure that you change your heart. That's why it's called the Way of the Heart. Right? It's not the Way of the Head. It's not the Way of the Mind. Right? It's the Way of the Heart because this is the truth that we all need to come to face. The fact is that every single thing inside of our lives and every single thing in our environment is my own creation. And I can release an emotion and create something totally different. And I can also exercise desire in a loving way and create something totally different too. Want to say any more, Dave? Sorry. No worries. My pleasure. It's always good to have a gorgeous looking woman, aren't it? So let's just talk about for a moment some of the practical things that I've had to do to actually work through my emotions about anger. I was, in my entire life, there was only one time, before I was 33 years of age, there was only one time I was angry.
This life or last life?
This life. Well, I should say one time that I thought I was angry. Is that affecting the recording? Black? Yep, sure. And what I've had to deal with since, I realise that actually I've been quite angry, right, dealing with lots of emotions. And I've had lots of anger with God, I've had lots of anger with my soulmate, I've had lots of anger with stuff about myself. In fact, most of my anger has been directed at myself. And so I've had to work through these emotions. In the process of working through these emotions, I found some techniques that worked for me. And so what I'd like to do for a moment is share with you some of these techniques that work for me. The first thing that worked for me was to make an anger list. Now, what I included on the anger list is the things. Now, let me just define anger for you. Mild annoyance, mild frustration, mild irritation, annoyance, frustration, irritation, aggravation, disgruntled, displeased, exasperated, impatient, enraged, furious, incensed, outraged, indignant, irate, livid, fuming, belligerent. That's all the things I put into anger. It's actually on your handouts that I've emailed, so you'll be getting those as a list. Now, what I do is I say anything that even makes me mildly annoyed. Like, what happened with this issue that I was dealing with when I was staying with James and Paula in Stradbroke Island was, I started having a discussion with them about the world's money system. You remember that discussion? Yeah. And I started getting really into it, like, you know, the world's money system this and the world's money system that, and we don't need money at all. And off I went on my soapbox, right? So any soapbox issue is definitely anger, right? So you let yourself feel any soapbox issue. And Mary says to me, gee, you're quite angry about that, aren't you? Right, with Mary's comment to me. Yeah, I am. And as I said, yes, I am, I said, I need to get into this. So I went straight away and started allowing myself to get into it. And lots of things come up for me in this processing of this emotion. And so if I made an anger list about that, the anger would have been the world's monetary system. So that's what I'd write on the list. I'm angry about the world's monetary system. Why am I angry about it? It's inequitable. It's unjust. It's unloving. It's okay while you've got money. If you've got none, it's not very good. You have to buy your own food. Who here doesn't buy all of their, at least some of their food? At least some of your food. You don't buy any of your food, you know. So, in other words, you just get it given to you. No, nobody here does that. Well, I think you should just get given food. I think you should just get given a house to live in. I think you should just get given your clothes. Why shouldn't you? They're essentials, aren't they? Can you live without food? You know, I was in an airport in the USA, a bottle of water, just a pint and a half or whatever it was, $5.20 US in this airport. A bottle of water. You know how much a can of Coke was? 80 cents US. Same place, same airport. Right? I've got to pay for water. Like, I'm 70% water and I've got to pay for it? Like, I've got to pay somebody to get some water in my system? You've got to be joking. Like, These are essentials to life, are they not? And I've got to pay for them. What, you know, so can you see my soapbox? Can you feel my soapbox?
Yes.
Okay. Anger in it, see? So what I was doing is allow myself to connect to all of this. And it started getting really personal. The reason why was that the whole reason why I died in the first century was because of the monetary system. So whatever anybody's told you about why I died in the first century, it's actually about the money. That's why I died. What happened was, the things I was saying to people by just doing what we're doing today, just talking to groups of people, the things that I was saying to people were causing people to question their entire existence, which included questioning their entire religion and questioning why they had to pay for sacrifices and so forth, and why they had to pay taxes, and all of these other things were all questions. Now, if you were a person who got 30-something tons of gold every year because of people doing these things, what do you think you would feel about the person who thinks that wanted to stop doing it? Right, quite upset, wouldn't you? Right? And this is exactly what happened to me. I died for that reason. I died because of the world's monetary system at the time. So there was a lot of emotions there for me about that. Right? Just my wife, my child, and all the suffering they experienced after my death was all the result of the world's monetary system. It was a result of how things were in the world at the time with regard to money, in the Jewish system of things. So do you think I was pretty upset about it? And this emotion, before then, I never knew why I got on this soapbox thing about the world's monetary system. But it got personal. It got very personal for me. And so I went through lots of emotion about that while we were together. And as the guys know, I didn't even go out to dinner one night. I was crying all that night. And so I basically stayed in that emotion as long as it took me to stay in it. And there was lots of facets to it, you know, about how it affected my wife's life, my daughter's life, everything, and how my life was cut short. All the beautiful things that I wanted to accomplish with my life, all the things I wanted to accomplish in telling the truth, was all just cut short because of money. So do you think I've got some issues about money? I sure am. Right. So I made an anger list. The world's monetary system's always been on that anger list, by the way. The next step is to ask myself why I'm so angry about it. So why should I get angry about that? This gets back to that question about justifiable anger, isn't it? Like, a lot of times what I'm doing with my life is I'll be justifying why I should be angry about something. The world's monetary system is totally unjust. It's created by a few people for the total suppression of your life, right? So why should I get angry about it? Yeah, I'm angry about how much your life has been suppressed, your entire life, by this world money system. Now I'm justifying my anger. You got me? Now I'm actually saying, I've got a good reason to be angry. From God's perspective, do I have a good reason to be angry?
No.
No, okay. So I need to at least admit that this is how I feel. I feel like I've got a good reason to be angry because this is so unjust. We need the feeling in me. Was, in particular then, we need to destroy this, is the feeling. And remember what I've said, any time we focus on destruction, definitely a lot of anger there. So why should I get angry? I feel that the world's monetary system is so terrible that I want to destroy it. What am I afraid of? What am I afraid of? It really got down for me that I was just afraid of dying because of the world's money system. Because there's a lot of things I'm teaching you, right, about soul condition, soul attraction, all these kind of things, that if you follow up on it, your life will change, and things will change around you, and one of the things that are going to change around you is the politics around you. Do you think you're going to need someone to govern you? When you're in 100% of love, do you think that you will need anyone to govern you?
No.
Never. You will not need a single governor. So what do you think that's going to do for the people who are addicted to power? Don't you think they're going to get angry with you? Probably. Right? So why am I afraid? I'm afraid of dying because of their anger with me. Right? And that's what it got down to with me. I was just afraid of feeling that I was just going to die. So the interesting thing in my life when I look back on it now is every time I've had to deal with money-based issues, I would get terrified. Even when I had a fairly, you know, four businesses going in my life and everything, and I started dealing with money issues, I started getting terrified. I mean terrified, like I would not do my accounts for long periods on end. Because I just felt afraid of the money. When I did my accounts, it was really easy, you know, tap, 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 bang, done in a few days, and it was all done for a whole year. But I would procrastinate and procrastinate and procrastinate and procrastinate rather than dealing with it. What was I afraid of? This issue of feeling that there's something about my life being threatened in dealing with this issue. You know, it's amazing how little tiny things, you know, affect your personal life and how it affects you inside of yourself. What else can you do? Write down the emotion that you may be afraid to feel. So what am I afraid of? What's the emotion? The emotion in me is emotions of loss. Loss of my family, loss of my life, loss of all of my goals and ideas, like my desires, that they won't be fulfilled, loss of all those things. And I needed to feel all of that, which I did a lot of doing. What would you do if you were at one with God? Do you think you'd care about the world's money system? It wouldn't bother you in the least. It wouldn't affect you in the least. You would have no angry emotions about it. You would have no sad emotions about it. You will have no justifiable anger about it. You just won't feel those emotions anymore. And ironically, you will live your life and you will use the money if you need to use it or not use it, whatever it may be, but it won't bother you.
I've got a question about that in anger, particularly when the ramifications of the world system is affecting probably a lot of people in this room, loss of jobs, our families, all that kind of stuff.
Yep. Yeah, that's right. A lot of people are so worried about it, but a lot of these worries are not real. When I say not real, like, why are you working? Let's say for a moment that everybody who needed a house in the audience automatically got one, because everyone else here helped them build one. And then every person here who needed food automatically got food, because everyone else in the room automatically helped them get food. And everyone here who needed any clothes automatically got the clothes they needed, because everyone else here helped them get the clothes they needed. In other words, we're constantly looking after each other. What else do you need? Well, yeah, now we're starting to talk about emotional needs, aren't we? Like, the real physical things that you feel you're working for, can you see that they wouldn't even matter anymore? If you were assured of getting them, why would you strive for them? You wouldn't anymore, would you? Can you see how the fear that, oh, if I don't earn this money, if I don't do this, this fear is all being created by the world money system, by the way, in an effort to control you, to make you so embroiled in a life that's about caring for your basic necessities that you no longer care for your real necessities, which are all spiritual and emotional in nature. The truth is that if we had a house to live in and we had a little plot of land ourselves, you know, 2 hours a day of work and you'd be able to be completely self-sufficient. 2 hours a day. Well, you look like you don't have to sit and watch a lettuce grow, do you? All you've got to do is plant it and water it occasionally, isn't it? You don't have to sit and watch a fruit tree grow, do you? All you do is plant it and water it and care for it, and it grows automatically, doesn't it? It's like, and then it produces what? One fruit tree. I heard someone recently say they counted like nearly 1,000. I forget what it was. Remember what it was? So they said 1,000. They had 1,000. 890 or something pieces of fruit. Oh, it was you, Brian. What were they? Bananas. On one bunch. That's it. One bunch of bananas. Was it 890? 900 bananas on one bunch. Right? That he grew in his backyard. Like. And you had to watch every one of them grow, didn't you? Like, you just sat there and you just tried so hard. You did all this work to make them grow, didn't you? No. In the highest spheres of the spirit world, what actually happens is your soul condition automatically looks after everything around you that you want. Right? So and you'll see this happening on earth soon when your soul, with your own soul condition. It's a bit like this. Imagine yourself going on a long journey. Like when you were going overseas for 6 months. And imagine when you came home that your property was even better looking than when you left to go overseas. And nobody was there. Because that's what your soul is capable of doing. Of maintaining everything. Watering it all. Everything. It's capable of doing everything. And in the spirit world, in the higher celestial spheres, that's what happens. This whole, like, planets, you could picture them as here, that are just the reflection of your own soul condition. And everything that happens on there is total reflection of your own desires. And you can have a desire and not even be there, and it will grow. On the opposite side, like, it's like you being on the opposite side of the world saying, oh, well, I just saw a banana tree. Bananas would be great in the backyard. And all of a sudden when you get home, bananas are in the backyard. Sorry? We don't need to eat. But it's fun eating sometimes, isn't it? So the truth is that we are powerful creators, but we don't create powerfully because we are yet to activate our free will in harmony with love. That's why we're not creating powerfully. And so anger is the key to creation, because in a way, like when we do these anger list thing, what we'll start doing is identifying all the areas in our life where we actually are feeling powerless. Right? And where we're not acting in harmony with our free will, in harmony with love. That we're using our free will to deny love, in fact. This is what anger is all about. So let yourself start working your way through the emotion of anger and digging deeper into it, because it's such a powerful change in you. You'll notice it. Now, last weekend, you remember on the Sunday, three or four, five or so of the ladies went outside and had a big spring, which attracted the police to come. Remember that? For those of you who were there. I don't know if you felt those ladies when they re-entered the room. So those of you who were there, did you feel them when they came back into the room? What did you feel? Did you feel they were harder or softer? Softer. Lot softer, weren't they? And did you feel that they were, when they came back in the room, they were more connected with their own emotion, weren't they? Did you notice that? Every one of the ladies who went out were more connected with their own emotion when they came back. So the beauty of dealing with your anger is your heart becomes softer. When your heart's softer, you can feel what's underneath better when you deal with your anger. Jen? Is it a question?
Yes.
Come on, Gail.
In the room. I wanted to ask a question earlier when they were here, but I wanted to follow what you said yesterday about resisting speaking up, and now they've left. None of what you've been talking about is helpful because of the impact of the amount of anger I've had in my life. Mm-hmm. has destroyed theirs. I had Jeffrey sitting beside me, and I turned to him and said, "Are you okay, son?" And he projected back the anger that he's had from me all of my life, and said, how can I be all right? I just want you to stay away from me. I'm having problems connecting with what you've said about justice. What are you talking about? Anger, I've got it. These two are so precious to me. They came into my care in innocence, just like I came into my parents' care in innocence. I believe you're Jesus. I'm asking you.
Now you're projecting it back.
I'm asked, don't care.
No, I do.
I'm asking you.
Yeah. What?
Please.
Please what?
You ask everybody here to connect to their anger, but the consequences of that is what you see, what happens to the rest of your family, what happens as it snowballs.
But I'm not saying to project the anger. I'm saying to connect to it and own it within yourself.
I didn't know when they were really little.
I know you didn't know. I know you didn't know. But you're now experiencing the results of the effect of the denial of your underlying emotions. So this is.
I didn't know I was denying.
I know you didn't know. And this is the problem with awakening, is that we need to experience the pain of awakening. Do you understand that?
The pain's too great.
No,
you're asking everybody
here. Yeah. I'm asking everyone here to experience the pain that you're now experiencing.
I don't recommend it.
I know.
I'm not telling you you're wrong. But this today.
Can you imagine? Do you remember those slaves?
Son sitting beside me.
Yeah.
Is the most challenging thing.
Yeah. Because you're seeing the direct results of your own actions.
I didn't do it on purpose.
I know you didn't do it on purpose. But it was done. Now all you need to...
What do I do?
You take this to God now. So what you do is you talk to God, and what you're feeling now is the truth.
I don't want people to see. I'm ashamed.
You can turn your head this way. What you're doing now is you're taking this emotion, this feeling of sorrow, to God now. It will change because you are now sorry. Before you weren't sorry. Do you understand the difference? See, before when you were saying, I want my boys to change, I want my boys to do, or I want my boys to do all these things, you weren't feeling the full responsibility of what you created. Now, in this grief, you're feeling the full responsibility of what you created. Now
I came innocent to my parents.
Doesn't matter.
What do you mean? It doesn't matter. It all matters.
No, it doesn't matter.
Because of the impact on them.
I understand the impact on them. What I'm saying is, you're feeling that this is not just.
It's not.
It is.
Then I don't understand.
I know. The truth is that whether we do things in innocence or whether we do things without knowing or not, it still damages our children. It still damages everyone around us. This is the thing that God wants us to come to see, what you're now seeing. That you have damaged your own children, even though you didn't know you were doing it at the time.
I've embraced all of this for 9 months to get to this point.
Yeah.
And I want with all my heart to leave.
Uh-huh.
I want to run. I want to run.
Because you don't.
But Jeffrey sat beside me in such pain.
But you didn't want to run.
And I can't, please. I can't because of his pain. It's not my own.
But that's why you want to run. You want to run because you don't want to see the results of your own actions.
Am I so different to anybody else?
No. Everyone else wants to run too when they see that they've done damaging things. The key is to not run. Don't leave the room when the shouting begins. Don't run. Feel your own emotion. When you feel your own emotion like you're doing now you're repentant. Remember, we've talked about repentance. Repentance is a true, heartfelt feeling that I can see the full results of everything I've done.
But what about their pain? That I can repent for me, but what about what happened to them?
Well, you doing this is part of your repentance. This is part of your repentance of seeing what you've done. And once you feel this fully, that lowers their burden straight away. That
there isn't any justice here at all. There's no justice because at every point your free will is impacted. You come into this world, into my parents' life, an innocent person, and you get compounded with stuff from them. You go through your life and you try and survive, And I wanted my children, I asked for Jeffrey and Nicholas, and you go through your life and you think you're doing the best you can. And you get to this point.
But can I ask you, Jen, when you were yelling at them, do you feel you were doing the best you could? Right at the moment you were yelling at them, when you were dumping your anger on them, did you really feel you were doing the best you could?
I don't ever remember yelling at them. I remember being angry within myself and withdrawn from them and not knowing how to love them.
Yeah.
Not knowing how to reach them or meet their needs. My sins are my sins of omission rather than actually physically hurting them in such a way as hitting them, or in fact I think I was probably a lax disciplinarian, if that's a funny way of putting it. And I know that's not the right way of putting it. But I didn't actually hit them. I tried my hardest to guide them, but my own guidance was was already warped.
Yeah.
Was already.
So this is the key thing that all of us need to come to see at some point. And that is that all of the things that have happened to ourselves, we have actually then perpetrated onto others. So how can I have judgment for what you've done if I've done the same thing? And in the end, once I need to, all I need to do to have all of this forgotten is to connect to God and feel that sorrow that you're now feeling.
But there isn't a minute in my own life that I haven't felt afflicted in some way, either from the physical people that were in my life or from some spirit interaction. I mean, I'm burning up now. It's not just me here.
No, there's lots of spirits too.
All around. But and they just don't leave me alone.
But you can you see that you still have a feeling of blame towards God even? You feel that God has done all this damage.
Is this whole system like it is? Because it's just wrong. System can't be right when there's so much pain.
Who created it? Who created the pain?
People's errors, my parents' errors,
and their parents' errors. And if all of us said, like, if I didn't have any personal pain, would I bother about your pain? In other words, would I care about your pain if I didn't have any personal pain? So if I'm creating your pain and then not feeling the consequences of those actions, then will I ever change?
My God, I
know. So you just need to feel. The feeling you have is that it's all unjust. That's the feeling you have, right?
I want the pain to stop. I want the change. I'm committed on doing it. I'm here.
Yeah. But darling, the pain's going to stop only when you fully feel what pain you've created. It will stop then.
Too much.
much.
No, it's not too much.
And then I will watch my kids with all the ramifications of the things that I did.
Yes.
Consciously and unconsciously.
Yes. And once you let yourself feel all that, you'll feel fully repentant. And then that's when God's love can enter you and just rub out the memories of these things from an emotional perspective. But only once you've reached this state.
When do I find the faith to keep going when the pain is so great? Just tell me.
Well,
I just don't know he's there. And I'm angry at him.
I know you're angry at him. Yeah. How many of you feel angry at God? Just like Jen's film. So quite a lot. So this is common emotion then. I've been really angry at God too.
I want to die, but what's the point of that? You can't go in the spirit world and you can't escape it.
That's right.
We're trapped.
That's right.
You can't get away from it. It's
so what are you trying to get away from?
I just want a little bit of peace. Just time enough to find myself.
Yes.
I feel lost.
So talk to God about this. But you're so angry with God, how can you talk to God?
I'm talking to you. No next best thing.
No.
Why not?
Because there's no next best thing to God. I'm not the next best thing. Well, because I'm not God. The person you need to heal the relationship with is God. How are you going to heal the relationship with God if you don't talk to God about this issue? You need to talk to God about how you're feeling, how angry you're feeling towards God.
I'm sitting on my hands in the audience, talking to him all the time.
Awesome. But it's all of these emotions you've now voiced to me, you need to voice to God now.
Is he not listening now?
Yes, he's listening to you. You're not directing it at him. You're ignoring him. You feel emotions of blame towards him. So you start talking to him about how much you feel that. How much you feel the whole system's unjust and all those things. When you work through this emotion, you'll feel it entirely differently. And in fact, the reason why the system's been created in the way it has is so you could come to this realization. This realization that all the damage that you have done and how bad it's been. That's the reason why you've come to this place.
I don't want to be putting up my hand and asking questions all the time and taking up people's time for whatever is perceived, you know? People come to me and they say, you put your hand up, that's a really great question. I don't want that anymore. All I want from this situation is to heal my life and have change.
And you need to yes, I do, but you need to feel this pain to do that. You do need to feel this pain and talk to God about this pain that you feel. This is what repentance is, Jen. This is what repentance is. Repentance isn't some intellectual exercise. It hurts. Repentance hurts.
You're not helping.
I'm not helping, no, because you don't want to hear this. I don't want to stop you from feeling repentant. I want you to keep going. If you keep going, you'll get to the bottom of this and you'll understand. It's all right, you don't have to stay if you don't want it. Can everyone understand why Jen's feeling the way she's feeling? Yeah. How many of you feel like this whole system of parents passing on emotional damage to children is just like out of whack, it shouldn't be happening? How many of you feel that? Majority of the audience. Can you see how angry with God we are? Can you have a desire for God's love if you're angry with God? Can you see how there could be a problem there? Like, can you see firstly you're going to have to experience some rage with God and let yourself feel that anger with God and really express to him how you feel, the frustration you feel about it? When you do, I can guarantee to you that at the end of it, you will come to see that God wasn't the creator of this. But at the moment, most of us feel that God is the creator of this. You feel that God should have made you like a robot instead of like this free will individual. Because you don't want the other person having free will at the moment. Because what do they do when they have free will? They just hurt me.
That's all they do. Can you see that?
It's because we're not taking responsibility for our error initially.
Well, yes, a lot of it is because the reason why we feel so enraged with God is because most of us have a huge amount of personal pain that other people created. Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
You think of all of the personal pain that you have in your life, how much do you feel you created? But let's face the truth of it. The truth is that the majority of your personal pain was created by the time you were 7 years of age. So did you know that you were creating it during that phase of your life? Of course you didn't, did you? So who created it? The previous generation, didn't they? And then for that generation, didn't the previous generation beyond that create it? And for that generation, didn't the previous generation beyond that create that pain? Can you see what's happened? This multi-generational passing down of pain. Most of us hate the system, don't we? Like, do you like the fact that you've got all of, pretty much all, most of the pain you have within yourself, you believe, and I say this for a reason, which we'll see in a minute, you believe other people created. So does that feel fair to you? Do you feel angry about it? When you connect to the anger and then connect to the grief of it, you'll release that feeling. When you release that feeling, there'll be an entirely different feeling that will overwhelm you. And that is that this system that God created is the only possible system that could have been created with free will as the basis. And that when we make choices disharmonious with love, there are painful results, not just for us. If you make a choice disharmonious with love in your family, your children will feel the pain of that as well as you. Now, do you love your children enough to stop the pain? Well, we say yes, but most of the time we don't mean that. Most of the time we don't, because we continue their pain. So we say yes, but we don't mean it. You look at the pain that's going on in the world today. If you could see that you were the creator of it, what you're choosing right now is the creator of it, what would you choose to do? Surely you'd choose to stop it, wouldn't you? And the only way to stop it is by dealing with the soul-based emotions inside of you. That's what I'm saying to you. When you stop that, this world pain will stop. This multi-generational pain will stop. The whole reason why it's there right from day one was because the first human couple decided that the course of self-reliance was going to be the best for everyone. And remember, some time ago I said to all of you that the biggest emotion inside of you will be your desire to remain self-reliant. You don't want to admit that you've done things wrong. You want to admit that everyone else does things wrong to you. Right? And all of us feel this way at some point. That's our anger. And we need to connect to it and feel it and release it. And when we do that, what will happen is that all of the truth will become, we'll be able to see all the truth. But before that time, we won't see the truth, and that is that God created a perfect system to expose your choice to deny your emotion. Does that make sense? That's what God has done. Can you come up here? Most people don't know how what. And the truth is, and I know this is again a blunt truth, but the truth is that those who really want to know how always find how. So the truth is the majority of the world does not want to know how at this point in time. As you deal with your emotions and you become happier in your life and you release these emotions, you feel that process of repentance and you work towards God and feel happier after you've worked through the grief and the sadness and those emotions, your life will be a demonstrating point to them of what happens when you choose to actually seek how to deal with things. And when that happens, they will look at you and they will say, wow, they've made a lot of changes. I want to be like that person. And then they'll want to know how. But it requires at least one of us to do this before others will follow our path.
the problem with the world today oftentimes is, yes, people don't know how, but the truth is also that most people don't want to know how. You look at how much difficulty all of us in the audience still are experiencing accessing our core emotion. How many of you had a mild or annoyance or irritation or frustration last week? Right? That tells us that all of us last week still are struggling with getting into our core of emotion. And this is people who have been now, like many of you have been hearing these things for a year. So you imagine the resistance that's out there to them really wanting to know what their causal emotion is. This is a group of people who really want to know. And out there, there's a group of people who don't want to know at all. But without you changing, without it changing your life, they won't ever see the results of it. And it's because people can't see the results that they don't want to do. And that's an issue most of us are facing. Most of you are facing at the moment, you're saying, you're hearing from me that I cry 2 or 3 hours every single day. Now, does that feel very encouraging to you? No. How long have I been dealing with emotions? For years, right? And I've been dealing with it for 5 years with my relationship with God, and I still am crying 2 or 3 hours every day. What's going on? The feeling inside of you is, does this work? But most of you have been with me long enough to now to know to see the changes in me in the last year, yes?
Yes.
So have you noticed the changes? Just like I've noticed the changes in you? Yes, you do notice changes. You do notice differences, right? So you see the results. So this does work. But at some point, we need to come to terms with how much anger we have within us about having to do it. Carol. Well, now I get donated enough funds now to live on that I wasn't ever happening before, right?
So,
I had a blockage to receiving, I had a blockage to money, I had a blockage to... But now I get enough funds to live on just through your donations. And that wasn't happening before. So, as soon as I dealt with that emotion, money just... You started donating more money so that I could live on it. Before then it was looking... Mary was starting to get a bit worried, but we're going to have to go and get a job and we're not going to be able to do this, was the feelings there before then. Because that emotion inside of me was blocking everything from happening. Please?
I just wanted to make the journey
So you were connecting to Jenny,
yeah.
Yep. Yes. So the question is, your son came in to hug you the instant you started crying when you were connecting to Jenny's emotion. Okay, you're in denial. Yep. What happens is when we have a child, if our child comes up to hug us when we're crying, it's because we want to get out of the emotion. You'll find if you want to really get into the emotion and you really stop and cry, your child won't come and interrupt you at all, and they'll wait until you're completely finished, and then they'll probably come and see you. Right? I've had times where a person's sitting right next to me and I'm talking to them about their emotion, and their child from outside's come in and give them a hug and distracted them. They don't want to deal with that emotion. Our children feel our projections so well, and they respond to those projections. So as soon as Jenny started feeling some of the grief that she feels about the injustice of what God's created, which is the grief that many of the spirits around Jenny are also feeling, you started feeling that same emotion, but you did not want to feel it. And as soon as you don't want to feel it, there'll be something occur around you to distract you from feeling it. Yeah. Phone call, son, daughter coming, give you a hug, distracting you, all of these things all happen. Have a cup of tea, cheer yourself up, chocolate. All right, now, can I just get back to the anger discussion, though? I have said in the outline a lot more about anger than what we've discussed. My suggestion is have a good look at that outline when you receive it. It talks about, firstly, the stages of suppression of anger and why you choose to even suppress your anger. Then it talks about why you even get into anger. And I'm not suggesting that all of you become angry, rageful people here. What I'm suggesting to you is to recognise when you are actually angry and to understand that in that moment you are denying an emotion underneath the anger that you do not want to feel. And if you use your anger as a guide to link you down into that emotion, you'll get to every one of those emotions really quickly. But if you don't use your anger as a guide and just skip over the anger, you'll stay in a stagnated state for a much longer period of time. So if you choose to suppress your anger, or you choose to stay in your anger, you will not progress on the divine love path. You won't even progress on the natural love path using those methods. Because both paths require that you get into your real emotion. So start allowing yourself to progress by actually seeing the threads of irritation and annoyance and all those kind of very mild feelings you feel, and allow yourself to dig into that emotionally. Really start confronting those feelings within yourself. Allow yourself to dig underneath and find out what is going on. If you do that, what will happen is that you'll progress very rapidly, and you'll allow the experience of the emotions the anger currently is denying. Because it's the anger you use is there to get you away from another emotion. It's there to keep you from God in a way. It can be your guide to God if you see what you're doing. But it won't be your guide to good if you don't, God, if you don't see what you're doing. Anger always caps in a causal emotion. However, it may not be exactly what you're thinking. For instance, I might be getting angry because I'm refusing to make a choice to do something different. And I want everyone around me to change and me to stay the same. So what's the causal there? The causal there is I want to control everyone around me. I want everyone around me to conform to what I want. Does that make sense? So the anger certainly always caps a causal emotion, but the causal emotion may not always be what you suspect it to be. And that's the thing, is if you allow yourself to experience the anger in a safe environment, like what Ian demonstrated, you know, with his anger kit, allow yourself to experience the anger in a safe environment, you will very, very rapidly get into the causal, if you really want it. The big conundrum we all face with regard to anger is this. The fact that anger exists within me means I'm already wanting to deny the causal. So I'll say that again. The fact that anger exists within me means I already want to deny the causal. So the thing that I need to start praying about, if that's the case, if I'm getting angry all the time, is I really need to start praying about why I want to deny the underlying emotion. And it will always be something I'm afraid of. Guaranteed. Always be something you're afraid of. How do you explain something like Tourette's syndrome? Something like Tourette's syndrome? Tourette's syndrome is an anger in the person themselves, which, and the very mediumistic person, and there's a heap of spirits in that angry state as well, and they connect to them. And then they just go into a tuned out state themselves, and the spirit just expresses their anger through the person. That's why they'll be talking like a fucking moment, and off they go, you know, and then they're talking along. What's happening at that moment, that interspace, is there's a spirit connecting to the person, expressing their anger and rage in that moment. Does that make sense? And then they detune from that, and then they're way back into normal life, which is the suppression of their own anger. So if they allowed themselves to connect to their own anger, they would actually find the spirits would have less influence in terms of the syndrome, but they would be experiencing their own anger. But remember, when you start experiencing your own anger, the goal of this isn't to experience your anger, but to dig deeper into the grief or into whatever the causal emotion is. So if the person who has Tourette's digs into the causal, they'll find that the disconnection with the spirits who are doing that will occur. And they'll be highly mediumistic as well as a subsequent result. Brian, thanks.
Hi, Jay. These days I've become more and more aware of bright spirits around people that may get sick or whatever.
Yep.
Do I have the right to point that out to them?
It's up to you what you do, Brian, in terms of what you notice. Obviously, sometimes it can be a loving thing to point out to somebody something.
That's
it all depends on your motive. Yeah. So what's your motive? If your motive is to gain glory or accolades or power or whatever, then I would refrain from doing it and look at the underlying emotion. If your motive is to actually, you know, connect to the person and give them some love and demonstrate to them that they have people around them who care for them, no matter what they're going through, then it's a beautiful gift to give them. And the fact is your sight, your spirit sight, is a beautiful gift that you can utilise to help other people. All right, well, rather than answer any more questions today, tomorrow we've got the opportunity to ask lots of questions about anger. My suggestion, if you haven't already looked at your email and you get an opportunity to tonight, at least print out the list that we had today, that I have not touched very much of, by the way, in the discussion, and read through that and raise any questions you want about anger and the processing of anger tomorrow. For the first half, what I would like is that, so until 3 o'clock tomorrow, I would like all of your questions to be associated around anger or the processing of anger rather than any other subject. Is that all right? And then the second half of the session tomorrow, we might open it up to other subjects related to anger and emotional processing. But if we can focus for the first half on the anger itself. And I would like to thank you very much for your listening today. I know many of you found it quite difficult today. And to be frank with you, I found it quite difficult presenting today. I can feel my own voice closing down because I can feel the resistance in the hearers. All right? So that's the reason why I'm going to end early today. And I would like you to have a think about that, to have a think about why you find a discussion about anger as a group so difficult to hear. If you can do that, and maybe that's one of the things we could discuss a little further tomorrow for those of us that are coming back tomorrow, as to why you find this discussion quite difficult. Because it's going to be of such a powerful help to you if you can see what's going on within yourself with regard to anger. So if you can do that for me, I'd be much appreciative of that, because otherwise tomorrow my voice is going to close up altogether and we won't be even having a session tomorrow. And a question, Chris?
Two questions. Are you
going to
be doing with judgment? And secondly, what time are we starting tomorrow?
Can we make it 1 tomorrow rather than 1:30 as advertised? And yes, judgment is a capping emotion over anger generally. And so I will discuss, or we, when you ask questions, you can certainly ask questions about that subject.
Thank
you. Are the CD-ROMs out the front? CD-ROMs for anyone who hasn't got a copy of the pageant messages and would like a copy, for anyone of you who are new. They're free, so you don't have to pay for anything. There's 70 copies of today's anger session here. Now, if you can print out one at home tonight, please don't take a copy with you. Only take a copy if you feel you're not be able to get one printed out tonight. Is that alright? So they're here at the front for you to pick up too. Thank you for your time today.